coming to you from the Edge Podcast Studios at South Mountain, Phoenix, Arizona. Welcome to the Edge Podcast with Mike D. Buckle up, Edge Nation. It's about to get real.
On the Edge with Mike G here at the Edge Podcast, blah, blah, podcast studios. Let's try that again. At the Edge Podcast Studios. That's funny. That's what happens when you smoke a joint before you get started, you know?
Yeah.
Language kind of leaves you. Anyway, we are live at the Edge Podcast Studios here in South Phoenix, right next to the mountain. It's beautiful out today, man. It's perfect.
Oh, it was awesome. It was a nice drive.
Yep.
Down here. Yep.
Yeah, no doubt, man. So I've got two very important, I'm going to say, extremely important to our community guests. And the first one is Jim Brown. How you doing, Jim?
Hey, I'm doing great, man. Thank you. Homie. Thanks for having me on. I appreciate
it. And the next is Ben Vidoff. And anyway, so, and Ben, dude, we're going to start with you.
All right. Right on.
No, man. So so I hear really good things. And we just met, what, minutes ago, right?
Yeah. Yep.
And dude, you're a freaking cool dude. So tell me a little bit about what it is you do. You're a comedian. You've got...
I'm a stand-up comic. And as you put it, I'm coming to a dispensary near you. I like that. I just got hired at Emerald Dispensary, which I'm real excited to start at. And, you know, I've just been in this. I started off working at Trails years ago, like when I was 18, 19 years old. I've kind of been working in this industry since then, off and on, you know?
Yeah.
And it's real exciting to see where it's coming.
Well, dude, I mean, and not only that, but you're involved in you know, what is it, the games? What is that?
Oh,
you're,
the Cups.
The Cups, man. So you're also a judge?
Yeah, they occasionally, you know, I've been going out to those for a while. And they've been cool enough to allow me to judge in the past and stuff like that, which is insanely fun. You know, I've worked at a couple of those as well where, you know, they through just knowing people, you know, knowing the right friends, right place at the right time, you know, I was lucky enough to have those opportunities, and it's a blast. I encourage everybody from Arizona to try and go out to one. You know,
definitely.
You know, there's a couple in California, Denver and Seattle. They're just good time.
Yeah.
You know.
Well, there's a cannabis conference coming up in next week, right?
Yes.
Yeah.
Oh, that expo.
Yeah, the expo.
What, that's like a job fair, right?
I don't know.
More or less.
Is it?
It's a big industry networking event. So there's going to be all kinds of different, from what I understand. I don't represent it. However, from the advertising and things that I've seen and the people that I know who are going, there's obviously opportunities for dispensaries to set up booths there. There's going to be all kinds of vendors to people in the industry. So, you know, the manufacturers of CO2 equipment and extraction stuff and point of sale and all the latest shit's going to be there. And then, you know, they'll have a stable of attorneys that talks about all the different legalities, you know, those types of things where they have different, just sort of an all, industry encompassing type event.
So it's going to be a great event. Definitely get there. And that's a look, especially if you're an activist, if you're somebody involved in the community,
or if you'd like to be.
Yeah, or if you know nothing about the
I mean, if there's, with all the you know, quote unquote crazy cannabis shit going on out there that some people would call crazy.
Right.
I mean, if you really want to just educate yourself on what it's about and who these people are, and you really want to quite honestly, probably if you don't know anything about the plant and you're nervous about it becoming legal and all those kind of things, my suggestion is go down and talk to some people down there and ask them what they're about and why they want to see, and allow them to share their stories with you if you truly want to, you know, bridge the gap and understand what's coming. And I think what you'll find out is a lot of really amazing surprises. Where people will, I always say, if people had any fucking idea, the people who use this plant that assist you in your daily life across the board with high level functioning jobs, it would blow your mind.
It would.
So
yes.
Really, your fears, your unfounded
fears. Those are the ones that I trust the most. The ones no that don't smoke are the ones that I don't know if I trust you.
A little worried about them.
There does seem to be a little bit more of a flow and a little bit more of a connection to the soul. Not always. I know some people who don't use that are pretty kick-ass grounded people. However, they have other ways of, you know, of getting there. But
they're all right. They're
right. Yeah, like I know some yoga people and shit.
Yeah, I know into yoga.
Many yoga people. Yeah.
That's right. A little bit of yoga.
I know some karate people. Many karate people.
Where's this expo at again?
I think it's at the convention center. Yeah, downtown.
Oh, cool.
Yeah.
They're right now selling passes for half. I don't know what the fuck that means. Half price.
Yeah. Well, they were $140, and I think they're $70 now.
Wow.
Yeah. Whew. Definitely affordable.
Yeah.
Yeah. Definitely get there, man.
So there's a free plug to those cats, and also free plug to my true, honest friends at Emerald Palace. There's nobody paid for this, but that is really a kick-ass organization. They have if you've never had an infused soda pop, then you should get in your fucking car as soon as you hear this.
Yeah, I heard about those.
And if you have a medical card, and if you don't have a medical card and you haven't had an infused soda, then you should go get your medical card and then go get in your car and get one.
Yes,
I'm excited to start there for sure. Oh, yeah. We were talking about that stuff. I was very, very excited.
So you're starting there this week, next week?
As soon as that card gets through.
Yeah, agent card.
Agent card. As soon as that gets through. So
what does an agent card do? What is that? It's just so that you can work at a dispensary, or is that kind of like a food card? Like,
it's a,
I'm sorry, I don't mean to say
no,
right.
No, yeah.
Yeah, it's like you got to get a food card.
It's
before
like a food handler's
there,
card,
right?
But yeah, exactly. For medical.
Okay.
Right. It's a little more intense in that, you know, food handler's card, they don't require an FBI background check. So right. For your dispensary.
Well, yeah, obviously.
Dispensary agent card is in my opinion, it's what it sounds like, man. You're an agent of the state. It's from the Department of Health Services.
Yeah.
And
totally legitimate.
Yeah, man. I had to go get fingerprinted and everything. You know?
Absolutely.
Wow.
You know? Yeah, you have to
they
send
take
in
it
a,
seriously.
Yeah, they do a background check on you to make sure that there's no I'm pretty sure it's cannabis that it's drug related felonies, I believe is what they're looking for. But you are, once you have that card, what they probably didn't tell you yet is that, and they may not, but that basically with that card is a lot of power, because an agent can now transport for, dispensaries from one dispensary to another.
Power.
And, with an agent card and a manifest and all the proper paperwork.
Right.
And obviously
right.
The need to do that has to be provable, but, you know, in theory, an agent could carry in Arizona unlimited amounts of cannabis.
I was going to switch over the camera to you, bro, but I'm not.
No, I was listening to what he said. I was intensely listening.
I don't want people to know that you could be.
So it's what it is. It's the thing is,
target
obviously
this
we
man.
Don't.
We're, target this man.
The purpose is so that we can handle
I got my
it
face up here.
For the patients. Yeah, yeah. And the agents that are handling that amount.
Yeah,
you know,
yeah.
You don't know who they are, man.
And you know what's really cool is that there's a whole industry that I found out about that came up around just securing those people that transport back and forth, and
starting to see that
and money and other things, and so
many opportunities for entrepreneurs, man. I have people who on the regular want to have lunch and shit with me, and they say, or they ask me about getting in, and it's like everybody's focused on, man, if I had a dispensary, if I just had a, there are so many opportunities for people who really want to grind and work and
absolutely
contribute creativity, man. There's all kinds of ways to get involved.
Yeah.
Dispensary is just one small one, but these other services that do the
security
transport
and
security, all that kind of stuff. Also that there's some that are starting to do money pickup, I understand.
Yeah, that's what I had heard, that because there's quite a bit of money that changes hands and the product as well. I mean, that's got to be secure somewhere, right?
Right.
But that's fascinating to me. That's just one aspect, right?
Right.
I mean, what about delivery secure services and things like that?
There are a few dispensaries delivering. I know not many have So I'm not sure which ones are actually implementing that. And usually, I don't know why, but that just hasn't been a conversation that I've had. We don't deliver only because of the, well, we've been working on our cultivation now that that's up and running, those kind of things. Delivery service is probably the last thing that I think we'd work on here. Yeah. Only because it's so new and there's no real guidelines laid out that you're really having to really lay everything out. And
That's what I was going to ask. Is it like there are no rules for that? It's just kind of.
Oh, there is. There are rules, but they kind of leave some of it to the municipality. They leave some of it to the dispensary and DHS to sort of work out depending on your circumstances. Right. And so that's if I had to say of everything to do with dispensary related stuff, that's probably the one that I'm know the least about is how people are doing deliveries right now as far as the legitimate dispensaries. Now there's, you know, delivery services out there on Craigslist, those sort of things, who if you ask the guy delivering will tell you he's legal, but
not quite.
Right, there's prosecutors and stuff that would argue otherwise. So make your own.
Definitely want to avoid arguing with prosecutors.
Yeah,
If at all
careful,
possible,
be careful, please.
If at all possible, yeah.
You know what I could see for me, you know, just myself. I think about whatever, but I could see that, you know, there would be a pretty good sizable segment of the population that would need that kind of a service. You know,
absolutely,
as a possibility. So especially people that, you know, I mean, they're homebound or, you know, and they need the medicine.
In California, it's huge. There's like, I know lots of people that work for delivery services, legit ones, you know, that are actual from the dispensaries.
Well,
stuff.
Now I'm thinking of another way to make some money.
There's so many. Literally there is any.
Yeah, that's
dude,
just one.
You're already set up for it.
Oh, shit.
You have fucking.
I got a studio, right?
Just shit. I'm just saying that there's another way as opposed to getting people to the med or getting the meds to the people from the dispensary to there.
Yeah.
You can get the people to the meds.
Driving Lyft.
Say, hey, I understand it's going to take you longer to get in and out of my car.
I got a brainchild, man, dude. You and I, okay, listen, don't tell anybody, but I got this
you
brainchild.
You can edit this out, bro, right?
No, we're not going to edit it out. This is going to be fantastic. Instead of Lyft, we'll call it Splift.
Oh, bam, motherfucker. You need to get spliff.com right now. You need to go on
spliff.com.
Serious, bro. Go to GoDaddy right now. It's too late, fuckers.
That's awesome.
Too late. Spliff.com, though. Look for the app, you son of a bitches.
Oh, that's awesome.
Right. Private enclosed area you can smoke in. So I don't know the implications are for a party bus, though. However, there's, a party bus in that's what they call the outside of it. This would be a vehicle, something. We'd have to think of an acronym for.
Oh, dude.
Do you want? This is how I come up with business plans, how we're doing it right here, brother.
Spliffed.com is taken.
Spliffed, it is?
Yeah.
What about Splifty?
Splifty.
Splifty could even lend itself to a fucking reggae song, man. Done right now. Fucking,
try it with an I.
You take Splifty to a fucking Jamaican guy, he's going to come back with the next steer it up.
Spliffed.
Next three little birds.
It's available.
Man, where the hell are services like that when I was in my 20s? Right. Bars.
Oh, shit. I don't know about this one, though. This is going to have to be like a... I don't know about spleefed.
Spleefed.
It's available?
It's available.
Dude, it's
EEFT, though. It's not like IFT.
Can you do...
do Medicab.
Oh, lordy motherfucker.
Dude.
Medicab.
Holy shit.
Dude, you might have to pay Ben a royalty on that.
I will. I fucking totally will, dude. Medicab is taken.
Oh, really?
Oh, yeah.
Wow.
How about Metasplift? Is that too? That's too off. That's not good.
Spliff.
Now I kind of want to go see who took Medicab and see what they're doing.
Right.
Bet you it's out of Colorado.
Probably, yeah. All right, your domain is available. Metasplift.
What about What about my Splift?
Like my space?
Like my, but split? Why?
Why?
Splift. My Splift.
I'll bet you that's
got to be available. Yeah, That's available. So my spliff is available.
That's
look at all this work we're doing right now. Gary right? Vaynerchuk would be so fucking proud of us.
Fuck yeah,
we're productive people.
I think I probably annoy that fucker online because I don't use any of the social medias the way that.
He probably so fucking
Gary, injured. like you're sorry, a weather. You know who Gary Vaynerchuk is?
Oh like yeah,
entrepreneur guy.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. Ask Gary V.
We'd have like conversations about like business stuff and Gary Vaynerchuk shit and like you were saying, you're a weather nerd. We fucking nerd out.
Oh, weather alerts. I go crazy.
Same shit. Yeah. It's the same shit, dude. Yes. I'm like,
did you see that Gary Vaynerchuk thing on Monday?
That's what I look for weather alerts so that I know, because my favorite thing to do when it storms outside here is I'll roll one up, I'll go outside with my dog, and man, I'll put on like Frank Sinatra Pandora, and I'll just smoke through the thunderstorm.
Wow.
That is why I geek out to the weather. That is my favorite thing.
Oh, my
thing
God, here. That sounds fucking awesome,
dude, I'll put
bro.
That shit on, roll it up, and just chill. And like, that's, you know, people outside Arizona never understand that, but I'm like, when you never get storms, you know, you want to... Yep. Raise up and enjoy it.
Fuck yeah, dude.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Someone that in is... Seattle would be like, you fuckers.
Oh, anytime I go out to Seattle, they're just like, it makes no sense to them. They're like, why would you actually hope for rain? You're like, it doesn't depress everybody. You know?
Yeah, no doubt. Yeah, it's very connecting, man.
I'll tell you what, man. When I'm in the mountains, like when I do a lot of backpacking, like when I can, I try to get out like for at least 10 days or something where I'll just throw a backpack on, get my dogs and just disappear out in the mountains. I mean, like sometimes there's a trail, sometimes whatever.
Yeah.
And, but it's the goal is where I get to a place where I don't hear a single car, a single man-made fucking thing, except for an airplane every once in a while. And if I don't run into a person in those 10 days, I'm fucking fine.
Wow.
But when you're out in that situation and a fucking thunderstorm rolls through there, and you can feel the ground shaking, and you're in like this little canvas tent and stuff. Shit.
That storm last night woke me up.
Yeah,
I woke up, did a couple dabs to the thunderstorm. Can't complain about that.
Yeah, that was awesome.
I was driving last night, man.
Yeah.
Yeah, and it just fucking appeared out of nowhere. No kidding. Like one moment, nothing, and then two, three drops, and then it just unloaded.
This weekend, I was at the Taco Festival, the Arizona Taco Festival.
It
was the last day towards the end of it. It started to pour. It started to like come down, and I just taken a couple THC pills like hour or two before that. Plus, we'd been drinking.
Does your toe hurt when it starts to rain? Like, you have one of those reactions, so you just know.
No. You know what? It wasn't anything like that. But like, you could see, because like I said, it was towards the end of the whole event, last day. You could see the storm clouds gathering. You know, and I was there with my girl, and. Since it was the end of the day, nobody charged us any tokens for tacos. They were just giving it all away.
Wow.
So we had all these tokens left over that we paid for. And we were like, well, I guess we'll just piss it away on tequila and margaritas and stuff. So we're drinking. You know, meanwhile, you know, you see the storm rolling through, but you're not paying attention because you're drinking. Meanwhile, the THC pills are kicking in. So finally, by the time the storm rolls through, you know, we're hanging out in the tent, you know, just someone actually brought a bowl out there, you know. Oh. You know, I was like, all right, cool. And
An actual bowl?
Yeah.
Like, not one of those bull riding, like.
No, a bowl.
A bowl.
Yeah. Like the good kind.
A bowl.
Yeah.
I heard bull.
No. With the horns. A bowl to smoke.
I got it.
And so by then, I mean, I was got my buzz on. Sure enough, at the end of the night, walking back to the car, I slipped in this mud, just fell right on my fat ass, right on it. And the next day, woke up with like caked in mud with everything. It was fun time though. That taco festival was a good time.
Oh, yeah, man.
Yeah. Definitely stoner friendly.
Except for that part about, you know, flipping up and.
Did you lose
consciousness?
No. I lost consciousness from the tequila, not from the fall of the mud. The tequila had more to do with it than anything mud related.
That's funny, man.
But yeah, no, it was good. Dude. Good time.
No doubt. Yeah, I wish I had something like that happen to me last night, man. I just was picking up beautiful women and dropping them off. That sucked.
You said you had a good night, though, right?
I did, man. I made some dough last night.
Yeah.
Nice. It was fun. Yeah, I actually did. I had quite a few really good, you know, ride-alongs, man. People are cool.
You know what's funny is... everybody I know that works for Lyft or Uber, because a lot of comics do that, you know, for extra money here and there.
Right.
Everyone I know that works for Lyft and Uber have good things to say about it. everyone I know that's an actual taxi cab driver have these like nightmare stories. They'll tell you some of the craziest shit you've ever heard. But like people with Uber and Lyft are like, no, it's actually, you know, like people are very civil and I don't know what the difference is, but people are like well-behaved on those.
I don't know, man. I guess I have the personality for it. I don't know.
Sure.
I mean, it's just fun to do. It's fun to hang out with people. You know, you get into their lives a little bit.
Yeah.
And even if it's a, you know, couple, 3 miles away, you know, they're asking you how your night's going. You're asking them how their night's going. Usually if there's beautiful women in the car, that's a good thing. You know, and then just on, like the other day. So check this out. So I met this couple, right? And this is bizarre to me. I had no idea this was going to happen. So I pick up this couple, Kyle and Nicole and the Regans. Right. They're 20 something. And so, you know, I get them in the car. We're talking. They're very friendly, very cool. And I'm like, and they're not like they're tipsy, but they're not drunk. And they invite me in. And I'm like, yeah, sure. I'll go in. I'll hang out with you. They're like, come hang out with us for a little while.
Swingers.
Well, I thought that too.
Well, honestly, key party.
I did, right? I'm like, all right, well, this is cool. I mean, she's really cute. I don't know about him, but she's cute. Anyway, so that went through my head, but
he's going to have to massage my shoulders for a minute.
Right.
Right. The point being, but I got out and, you know, just hung out with him for like 5 minutes. And they asked me what I did, and I told them I got a podcast, and they lit up a little bit, and they were like, really? Well, what do you talk about? And I shared with them, and then I started making a connection because I had seen that she was making these right here. She had a whole station in her house like just filled with these that she was making, and they're wood, but they also have like this cool little silver thing, and then like a lava bead,
mm-hmm.
and she's telling it, and they smell good, like she puts a smell on it, right? I thought
she cool. puts a smell on it.
She puts a smell on it, bro.
At first, I thought you said she puts a spell on it.
That's a little spell.
That's why I'm
seen.
In love with her, right. And I want I don't want to have her babies. No, she puts this like a lavender or something. It's pretty cool smell. So anyway, so I'm thinking to myself, wow, I know some people, you know, like Rihanna Deal and Misconstrued and some other people, and maybe they could make a connection and help each other out. So I said that to her. And she like lit up. She's like crying. Really? Wow. You would do that for me? And I said, yeah. I said, why not? I mean, this is really cool. And then she goes, I want to make you one. So she runs inside and she made me this in like 2 minutes flat, dude.
What? So she made a custom one for you?
Yeah. Just right there. Fucking made it for me. Thank you, Nicole. You're very cool. Absolutely. Selfie time, bro.
Oh, yeah, there we go.
That's a good selfie too, bro.
Nice.
Show it to the camera, man.
I'm gonna post it on Facebook right now. Oh, selfie. Wait, nice. Hang on. I couldn't get a.
So that's crazy, though. You just, like I said, all the stories I hear from people on Lyft and Uber are all like nice tales, like of friendly people and stuff like that. Then all of a sudden, you're a taxi cab driver, and you're like, I pick someone up, they tried to murder me or hold me up or stick me up or rob me, and you're like, I would never do that job in a million years.
Yeah, no doubt.
Well, they just posted something about that the Uber rapist or something. They already have a fucking nickname for the guy. I didn't even know what happened, and he's already had a whole trial and everything, and they gave him 10 years, I guess.
Well, yeah,
I should hope so.
If you rape,
I'm not surprised they gave him 10 years. I'm surprised that someone would think that they could do all the out all the paperwork, do all the Uber stuff, go out and then stupid, just like
how do you expect to get away with that too? Like, you called this person to your house, like right. They know they've
you have, and the funny thing is that the truth is that even I get propositioned, man. So
yeah.
I've got a face for radio. That's
smooth
how I look
operator.
At it. That's how I look at it. But, I've been propositioned like 3 or 4 times, man.
Really?
In the last month. Yeah, the real deal. And
Just like lonely girls? Is it lonely girls that call it to proposition you? Or is it like drunk people that just are like, well, he might eat my pussy good or something?
The drunk girls are in the car, okay. Right? And typically it's after it's a 4 a.m. to 5 a.m. crowd.
Okay.
And the last one was 24. She was really cute. And, she was like frustrated because she got down with some guy and he just didn't do it for her. And she's like, so I'm still horny. And I'm like,
horny geez. Girls that just had their feelings hurt. Oh, there's nothing.
Yeah. Wrong. Right.
Nothing wrong with that.
Yeah. Well, I mean, I would, but at the same time, I'm keeping in mind, here's that Uber guy that got, you know, sent up for 10 years and it's her word against mine kind of thing.
Yeah. Wow.
And I'm definitely much older than her. And that, so I'm a little bit smarter than that, you know, at least I like to think I am.
You know what? You know what? If she was really that lonely and hurt, she wouldn't mind signing a waiver before you guys get it.
You know what? I'm like, I'm going to have to take video of this.
I like hearing stories like that. Honestly, like stories like that are good because it shows that like guys like us, like at our age can still get young pussy without having to do like Tinder or OkCupid. You're like, tales like that really still do happen.
Yeah,
like,
yeah, for sure.
I was just going about my day, and this young 24-year-old ASU girl just happened to be horny at the right time. And you're like, no, that doesn't happen anymore. And you're like, yes
it does.
Yes, it does.
Indeed, it does.
Yeah. I'm.
So what's it like, Joe?
Dude, I go home and smoke and hang out with my fucking puppies.
I love it, dude.
That's my Pablo Escobar fucking lifestyle. Yeah.
I was watching that this morning.
On the rare occasion that a chick makes it to my place, it seems to be that she's looking for information about the cannabis industry.
Really?
Yeah. I haven't. But
little bond humpers.
The truth is, I have not been chased. I've really been focused more on business than pussy. However,
yeah.
You know, that's not to say that there's not pussy out there that can't distract me.
Oh, indeed. Okay. Well said, my friend.
I agree.
Well said, my friend.
I can respect that.
I'm like, I am distractible.
At first, I was like, where's he going?
That's all I can say. I just got to throw my, you know, throw it out there because, exactly. You know, this is apparently my only lift type situation that I... working on right
Jim
now.
Jim should just take a couple shifts doing lift, like maybe once or twice a week.
That's next. That's my next thing.
Yeah. Trade my picture out. You can take my car.
Stuff. Oh my God. My fucking game.
Did you used to do that?
It fucking blows hard. I can't. No, I don't.
Really?
I
you got no game online?
No fucking game online. Shit comes across so...
Dude,
weird
when I first
or
got
creepy
on that,
or,
oh man.
You were pounding them too?
When I first got on that,
everybody I know is pounding
them. I broke up with a girl and it was actually Mike Kennedy. Mike Kennedy suggested I get on like Plenty of Fish and OkCupid and stuff like that. Because he's a hoe. I mean, he's a man hoe on that thing. You know, like I've had to warn him to back off my territory online. I've been like,
Because
girls that like I've talked to online, they'll be like, you're a comedian, and they'll be like, I met another comedian online. Like, let me guess, it's Mike Kennedy.
And I know what he smells like, honey. So
they'll be like, he's really funny, and I'll be like, oh, I know all his jokes, and I'll tell Mike about it. The next day, he's like, oh, I know that one. I've talked to her too.
That's a good impression of Mike Kennedy.
He is like that. He's like, oh, well, you know, I used to.
Do a Bilderberg rant on with Mike Kennedy.
Dude, that guy's hilarious, man.
Shit.
He's always posting up crazy shit of his, like, OkCupid and Tinder exploits and shit like that.
So what's some of the craziest shit that you've come across?
You know, well, I'm crazy as it is, so it's kind of hard for, like as a guy, it's a lot easier to brush off the crazy from girls because you're just like, you just stop talking to them. It's the girls that have the crazy stories from guys, you know, girls. I've most girls that have been like weirdos. I used to actually bring them out to shows all the time. Like the comedy clubs are the safest place to bring them to sometimes.
There's plenty of people there.
Yeah. Witnesses. So you can ditch out. One time at Stand Up Scottsdale, I double booked to two girls because I didn't realize. Yeah. This is the
Shit.
I pawned one of them off on Chris Bennett. I was like, Chris, I think this girl really likes you. You should hang out with her and talk to her. You know, at least lay down a distraction so she's not like, you know, lonely there.
Throw a carpet.
Smooth
bomb.
Operator.
Swear to you, it actually worked really well because the show is just enough to distract them. Meanwhile, my friend is going out and hanging out with one, you know, the one that I thought I stood the better chance with, you know.
So, right.
And the funny thing is all the staff and bartenders were all like rooting for me to like fail. Like they were, they're all sitting there like, Ben had two girls come
That's
out, keep an eye on this.
Time. You're like the fucking Rowdy Roddy Piper of the comedy club that night, man. They're fucking everybody's boo, and you're like,
you know,
bring it.
My days at that club, I was a rascal. My days at that club, I was a bit of a rascal there for sure.
Oh yeah.
Oh yeah.
That's fun. That's funny, man. So, where are you at now, man? Are you performing?
No, you know, like for the first time in my life, really, comedy's been kind of on the back burner. I moved to California for a while, and I was actually blasting wax. I was doing an apprenticeship, learning how to do BHO and, you know, making wax and stuff like that. And that took up all of my time when I was out there. And now that I'm back out here, my focus has really been on this new job at Emerald Dispensary and kind of getting more involved in the cannabis community out here. Once I'm more settled with that, I'll start doing comedy clubs. I'm supposed to do something with Ricardo tonight at House of Comedy. Some interview, I think.
Oh, man, I wish we were posting this right now, man.
Well, he just asked me about it like last night. You know? Yeah, Ricardo Rocha, he just asked me about it last night. So I have no clue what it is, but if I know Ricardo, he's sabotaging me and I'm walking into a trap. And
<he's>... Would he do that?
Oh, dude, me and Ricardo are assholes to each other. One time in Vegas, we were doing a show, and it was at Big Al's Comedy Club at the Orleans. And right before he went on stage, I go to shake his hand. I'm like, hey, man, good luck. And I took a bottle of vodka and I whacked him in the balls with a bottle of vodka right before he went on stage. And he was furious. The rest of the night, he was, I shit you not, the rest of the night, he would just grind his teeth at me and be like, I swear to God, I'm going to, you know, like he could not talk to me without grinding his teeth for the rest of the weekend. But he got me back really good. We were at Stand Up Live doing some show there.
Up, dude.
And Jill Bryan was the hostess. And, we're in the green room and I'm waiting to go on. And Ricardo leans over to me. He goes, dude, they just called you up on stage. I go, oh, okay. And I go out on stage as fast as I can. And Jill turns around looking at me because obviously she didn't call me up. And I'm like, oh, I just turned around because they have a camera. You know, they have a camera there that goes to the green room. I turn around and I just flipped them off.
You motherfucker.
Fucking asshole.
Oh, man.
So whatever it is that he's got going on at House of Comedy tonight, I'm willing to bet that it's going to turn into him being or you know what he likes to do? He likes to challenge me. He likes to, you know, be like, I could put you in a headlock, like little like 15, 13-year-old boy shit,
yeah,
you know?
Yeah.
So I know. That's what I'm saying. It's chill with you guys, but later on tonight, I'm just like going to have my dukes up being like, what trap am I walking into, you son of a bitch?
That's he's a funny fucking dude.
Yeah, he's cool.
That's awesome, man.
Yeah, he's real cool.
Dude, we get up there tonight, man.
Yeah.
Shit, dude. That'd be fun. I'm going to need to get some sleep at some point. You know, like eventually. Yeah, I don't give a fuck right now. I'm good.
Yeah,
but
cool.
Running off that red line.
Jesus, where is it? You got any?
I have. You know what? I quit doing all those energy drinks because I noticed as soon as I do them, they give me a burst for about 2 or 3 hours and then I crash afterwards. It's just easier for me to
5 hour energy
hallucinate.
Drinks,
not
never
even
made me crash.
When I'm trying to.
I never get that with those.
When I'm trying to stay. Oh, 5 hour energy doesn't?
The little ones, you know what I'm talking about?
Yeah.
I've never, because I used to do Monster and I used to do Red Bull before that. And
Monster's my.
Red Bull just made me feel like if I had too many. Yeah, but those things, they kind of like, they betray you in the end, you know? Like they, but I've never had that with 5 hour. You don't get all full, you know, it doesn't have any sugar or anything, so you don't. It just gives you.
They're the
you know,
strippers of the energy drink.
If they want to hire me as their sponsor,
the prostitutes,
I'm ready.
Man, the strippers are more like the monsters. Cause,
right,
you
they'll love you.
You get a little bit more.
The strippers, you know what the end. I mean the hookers, you know what the end is, mm-hmm. though. You the strippers always make you think that the end is a hooker, but it's
I don't
really
think Lamar
just
Odom
the end
was going to be the end.
The end
money.
Is she's a mom with two kids. That's what the end is.
The
man.
End is yeah. Sorry, yeah. I'm a mom with two.
I gotta go home.
Right. To go get my education on. Because I'm becoming a
college.
Working on my doctorate.
Fucking college. Oh, wait. We are way off topic already.
I'm writing a thesis.
Strippers, hookers.
Wait. We started with comedy, hookers. What else? No.
We started with agent cards, actually.
Didn't we?
We started off trying to be serious, in all fairness, we did. And it descended into hookers madness.
Right.
It's a perfect podcast, in my opinion. No, but I was gonna ask you, because, Jim, look, you've been around a while, and I got to sit in on another podcast that you did with Kevin, and I got to hear some of the stories of some of the bullshit that you had to put up with in the very beginning when, you know, medical marijuana was just, an inkling of a thought. And, that story right there, I think, is so valuable, and I want my listeners to hear it. So would you mind?
I wouldn't mind at all. No. Cool. I'll do the shortest version of it that I know.
Okay.
So basically, I'll start with the, there's so many, I could just chew up hours and hours and hours with anybody who knows me. I'm fucking talking anyway.
Well,
I can chew it up. But
the one thing that jumped out to me, mm-hmm. I'll just do some directing here, but the one thing that really stood out to me was the absolute mess that you had in zoning and trying to get a place and the licensing and everything else that you had to deal with, the politics and the way that they treated you. Absolutely. That right there was, I mean, and you just fucking barreled through it, you know?
Right. Well, as a team, basically what we had to, what we did was we had to, number one, so when we won our license.
You won your license?
Yeah, there was a lottery process that happened. Wow. So we were one of nine applicants. Our team was one of nine teams that had put in applications, and we won in our CHA.
Wow.
So, and there was a ridiculous amount of money that went into making that happen. So fast forwarding from that. So once we get that, we figured since we're the only one in the CHA to win, we were going to have our choice of nine different locations, because one of the requirements for your application was that you had to have a letter of intent from a landlord stating that he would lease to you if you had a license. And so that was one of the requirements.
Right.
At the time, those landlords were charging 10 grand a piece for those letters. It was pretty common knowledge that you could take one of us.
Can I get into that industry?
And so, yeah, so keep in mind.
Letter writing?
99. So when people talk about big marijuana and all this shit, number one, keep in mind I was doing all of this shit. My partner and I both living in a shitty one-bedroom apartment. Not able to pay that rent and just like scraping, struggling, trying to get this stuff done. Dude. The instant we won, there were several different lawsuits that started and all kinds of fights over the certificate and just over all kinds of various things you could pop. So all that stuff going in the background. And then we still had to find a building and get this thing open because there was a ticking time clock that the state had implemented into the actual law. The time clock was you had 1 year from the time of getting your dispensary for you to get open. Don't get open, then you, one, you lose your certificate. Two, you can never apply for a certificate or for any of that stuff in the state of Arizona ever again. That was the requirements at the time. So we did not make that 1 year deadline, and coming up on it, we ended up having to file our own lawsuit along with several other dispensaries at the state. We got into it late though because of the zoning battle and the other stuff that we were just all so many different pointed in so many different directions and wars on so many different fronts. And so we put in late for the rest with the rest of the dispensaries and actually were denied. The judge denied us entry into that lawsuit. And now,
damn.
It's all encompassing. It turned out that when they made the ruling that it applies to any dispensary in Arizona. However, at the time, it was unknown if it was going to just apply to the people who had filed the lawsuit or if it was going to apply to everyone who held a certificate in the state, because there were only 14 or 15 dispensaries involved in the lawsuit for the extension.
Wow.
So, and then there were many dispensaries who were fighting against that extension because they said, we got ours open and you should have got yours open. And
right.
Anyway, so there was all those kind of battles going on. Then none of these people who took $10,000 for these letter of intents would lease to us.
None of them.
All said, nope, sorry, I've reconsidered it. And I just
There was nothing binding them to it other than just here's $10,000 for a letter.
That is a hustle.
What a fucking bunch of jackasses.
It's a street hustle.
So, and that's just in one CHA where nine people put in. There were CHAs that people put in. I think the most I saw in one CHA was probably 14 or 15. There might have been 20 in a CHA, statewide there were over 500 applications put in.
That's crazy.
And obviously some people owned buildings and things like that were part of groups and that, you know, got in. However, it was very common to hear people charging $10,000 for those letters. So
this is what was going on in Arizona, and what year was that? The 2000.
It's going to be 2010.
2010
when it started. Yeah.
So folks that are looking in on Periscope, I just want to update you. We're actually doing a live podcast, the Edge Podcast with Mike G, and I've got Jim Brown in studio. He's one of the pioneers, really, of the medical marijuana industry, and one of the first, one of the top five, right? a first dispensary owners in Arizona.
Well, one of the first 99 for sure.
One of the first 99.
Yeah.
And very well respected in our community. We have a real, this guy is like, you know, an OG is what I want to say. Like
if you're
a homeboy, this is our OG for Phoenix, Arizona. And then we also have, we got Ben and this is actually their friends. They know each other. And Ben is also deeply involved in medical marijuana cultivation and testing and things like that. And also a really pretty funny guy, man.
Thank you.
Because he's also a professional comedian. And and I'm Mike G. So real quick, boom, that's that. And that probably looked terrible. But anyway, I just wanted the Periscope people because we got 11 people right now.
What is Periscope now?
It's badass. Still... We're live broadcasting right now while we're taping in a studio. And, you know, it's kind of fucking cool.
So that people can get on and they, as they like it, they create hearts for you.
I could read that.
Boosts you up, which gets more people looking at it.
I see everybody Periscoping now.
So we, yeah.
Wow. So Perry Lang just said, pot was the only thing that helped my girlfriend when she was pregnant.
Yeah.
The only thing that helped her eat.
With the nausea and stuff, I would imagine. Yeah.
Am I visible on chats? Yes, you are, Epic. And then also watching from Wisconsin. We got Parkinson help.
Hey, man. Right on, thank you for tuning in. Mad love from Arizona and the cannabis community here. And if you're ever out here in Phoenix, call Horizon, the health center. And if you've got some time, we do occasionally allow people to do tours. We can sign
G'day
you in
from
as a
Australia.
Visitor. Give you all the information right on, Aussie.
Australia.
Thanks for the response. Hey, no problem, Epic. Hey, listen, we appreciate you logging in and checking this out. And by the way, you'll be able to see this podcast live, and we'll have this segment on there. You'll be able to see this at the Edge. Well, go to edgepodcast.com, and you'll be able to click this in about a week. All right. But for this time, we're going to go ahead and shut this down. We've got so much to cover, you know. So, but thanks again for stopping by. We appreciate you, and hey, we'll see you next time on The Edge.
Wow, nice.
That was cool.
How many people did we end up with there? State of 11?
Let's take a look. Actually, there's a lot more than that. That was just who was actually viewing at the moment.
Oh, that's cool.
Several people click in and they'll click out.
I see so many people doing that now.
Yeah.
So you get different hits and stuff on it, too.
And
I don't know anything about that shit.
Yeah, me neither.
By the way, you can go find me on Edge Podcaster, at Edge Podcaster on Periscope.
Okay.
Yeah, download it and you'll find it. Let's see here.
It kind of seems like a live version of Snapchat, kind of.
Yeah, people are consuming right then and there.
Right.
We had, we had a total of, 15 people watching live and 41 stopped in.
Nice.
How many watching live?
15.
Wow.
And 41 stopped in.
I bet if you started doing a regular segment, like a time.
Yeah.
At this time.
4:20. Now you got to get the mic in front of you.
Oh, wrong.
Okay. We're going back.
Oh, did you guys pause it?
Yeah. Well, not paused it, but.
I'm sorry, man.
No, it's no problem. I want to keep it one continuous. So it was about 6 minutes. No problem.
Jim just got done going number two.
Definitely.
Number two break.
There was a spray in there, did you?
Hopefully you saw the spray.
I was in a hurry, man. It was on. I'm not certain.
Didn't notice it.
I'm not even certain I flushed.
Oh, shit.
I would never defile your place like that, sir, unless it was absolutely necessary.
I know. Let's see here. We were talking about
the zoning battles and all that kind of stuff.
Yeah, yeah.
So basically, after that, we go back to all of the known places that were already zoned. Because another thing was, in order to get this letter from the landlord, either the landlord had to pay to get it zoned, which that's another $5,000 to $10,000 in a zoning battle right there, just to get it zoned properly.
Right.
So you had to go through that, plus pay him his $10,000 just to get this place.
That
so
still blows my mind right
we
now.
We go back, and even though they had the zoning and all that stuff, they're like, nope. Sorry. So then we had to go basically create places to put the dispensary, which we created a few. We lost one zoning battle in one of the shittiest neighborhoods I've ever had the pleasure of being in, in all inclusive of my bail bond career and being
Where was
a bounty
that?
Hunter.
Yeah, wow.
Near Peoria and 19th Avenue over there behind Centerfolds and
Maryvale.
That place has gone. Yeah.
There was a lady was like, I was here last night. I was there. Here's a picture of human feces right at their front door, and it's like dated and shit. I'm like, oh,
that area's kind of shit.
Knew.
Yeah,
and I'm like, well, yeah, but that's why we're moving in, right? And she's like, I don't.
We're not gonna smoke that.
We're not gonna sell it either. You can have it.
Yeah. Keep the picture the shit.
And so it ended up, but that was because we were near, the reason we got chased out of there is because we were near Karsten Manufacturing, which for all of my cannabis people out there, they manufacture Ping golf clubs, and they heavily oppose marijuana and legalized marijuana. Ooh. And they did so by throwing tens of thousands of dollars at this zoning battle to keep us out of this shitty warehouse neighborhood.
They hated you so much they threw down all that money just to it's insane.
So everyone at Metro Center has Ping golf clubs also. So if you hate the fact that there's a dispensary at Metro Center, then you too have Ping golf clubs and Karsten Manufacturing to
What's another golf club place besides Ping?
Callaway.
Callaway, that's the one that I like.
Yeah, are they 420 friendly?
What I know is I've never looked across and seen any fierce-looking, angry attorneys from TaylorMade or Callaway. Yeah, right, yeah. You know?
Why would your dispensary, like, was their store actually there, or was it like their warehouse? Or
it's their where they just manufacture the clubs.
Why would they even care if your place is? I mean, first of all, if it was a store, I still wouldn't understand why they would care. Yeah. But I, you know, if I look through their perspective, maybe they don't. You know,
I'm going to jump out on a limb here and say that maybe there are some religious ties.
I'm sure.
You know what I mean? Like,
well, typically the only people I've not been able to have an adult conversation with, ironically, are the ones who are opposed because of religious reasons.
Yeah.
Go figure.
And the interesting thing is, if they would just talk to someone in their own religion, they'll find out that none of this conflicts.
In California, there's a dispensary.
If your religion allows you to drink tea with caffeine in it, you're good. Jesus, Buddha, exactly. You know, I understand. So that's basic. It's a plant-based, derivative.
If we all adhere to the, you know, if all three of us here were to adhere to the, you know, to the biblical model of creation, then we would have to assume that God created hemp, cannabis, marijuana, because here it is.
We'd also have to assume that I am going directly to fucking hell.
I was just gonna say. as we delve more into the religion thing, I'm like Satan, my dark lord and master, wouldn't approve of any of that.
None of that has anything to do. Cannabis might be the only thing that is I might be swinging from. I might be just the thread that's keeping me from the flames licking. Cannabis, probably.
Cannabis
the karma
is the one. Yeah, because
it prevents many falling down moments.
Yes.
Yeah. Also, just quickly, I just wanted to take a time and just take a second and say I appreciate the introduction and the OG. I'll call myself class of 2010 or whatever for Arizona and graduating first ever, you know, dispensary owners, and definitely have picked up the torch without hesitation and fought some crazy fucking battles. And before me were some real monster OGs. You know, got your Steve D'Angelo's, you got Heather Manis, and
mad respect to all of them.
Yeah, the people who have been fighting for this plant openly and publicly, doing smokeouts in Washington when Reagan was president and shit.
Oh, man.
That's hardcore shit there, man. And those, Jack Herer and those cats, and those are the real ones that we should pay homage
no doubt,
mad respect.
So
but I'm
thank
happy
you
to pick up the fucking torch.
Definitely,
fuck yeah, thank
represent.
You. Yes, absolutely. Thank you so much for all you've done. You know, I was one of the guys that, in my, I guess, my early days, I was one of those religious, you know, and I didn't think. I just honestly didn't even think that the fact that we had this plant on the planet was the result of, you know, either evolution or, you know, creation. And the funny thing is some people would ascribe some things to the devil, but creation's not one of them, you know?
Right.
Right. That was all God's doing. And so he's responsible. So, but that whole thing was that I was in that vein of thought, And for many, many years, I was probably your opposition. And it wasn't until recently when I found out that, you know, the human body is built to, receptor sites for cannabinoids. And it actually, everything links in real well and makes all those cells work perfectly or better, and is an inhibitor for cancer and a number of other things. Has a neurogenerative, aspect to it where it'll actually rebuild neural pathways.
Yeah.
Fucking amazing research out there. Science changed my mind.
I never understood. Even if you are religious, and you're like a super religious person, nowhere in the Bible does it really say anything all that bad about it. Like,
in fact, or correct me if I'm wrong.
Yeah, in fact, don't they say something to it? You know, like,
yeah,
that's the part that baffles me. Is it's not like it says in the Bible, like, it says stay away from like pork or shrimp or like some shit like that, and people don't give a fuck about that. But it says nothing about staying away from cannabis or smoking anything for that matter.
Yeah.
And yet people, religious people seem to shit their pants about it.
Yeah.
Which I don't. If anything, it seems to fall into religion much more than it would oppose it.
It actually, I think, there were incenses used in the Holy of Holies, and there were, nobody knows what it was made of. They say frankincense and myrrh, whatever they used for that special incense. But, who knows what they were using, man? I mean, I wasn't there, and then all of the different aromas that come out of like Egypt, right?
Yeah.
Those types of things. And they had medicinal purposes, and I'm sure marijuana was one of them.
I can't imagine it not being.
Right. Dude, imagine if we were like, it's just, I think about some of the fucking weirdest stuff when I'm high.
Some ancient alien shit.
Ancient aliens, yeah.
There should be a show like Ancient Aliens, but about pot. They're like, where everything just leads back to, well, they could have been stoned. Like, if you really look at it, there's evidence that these people were clearly high back then.
Right. Exactly, man.
That's so I have a Bible reference here if you guys want to.
That's what you've been doing over there.
Yeah, I was looking all up. Right. So there's a reference in Exodus 30, 22, and 23. That references a holy anointing oil as described in the original Hebrew version. The recipe in Exodus contained over 6 pounds of kane bosom.
Kane what?
What?
Kane, K-A-N-E-H dash B-O-S-E-M. Kane bosom.
Huh.
A substance identified by respected etymologists, linguists, anthropologists, botanists, and other researchers as cannabis, extracted into about 6 quarts of olive oil along with a variety of other fragrant herbs. The ancient anointed ones were literally drenched in this potent mixture.
Drenched in it. Wow.
Wow, dude.
So,
oh, man.
See, let me translate the Bible and religion would be way cooler.
No doubt. You'd relate it to either a rave party, surfing techniques.
It was
surfing techniques.
Exodus 30, 22-23.
There it is, man.
And so chapter 30, Moses hit the bomb.
22, 23, right?
Yeah, man.
The Lord spoke to Moses and said, hit that dab.
Hit it, Moses.
Moses was responsible for finding the burning bush, right?
That's
he came back, his eyes were all fucking red. They're like, Moses, hey, over here, Moses, put the fucking pita bread down.
Yep.
Moses, hey, what'd you find up there, buddy? Hey, buddy, hey, sit down, buddy.
They spent 40 years wandering that desert for a reason.
Right.
They're lost out there for that long. There's a damn reason.
He was high as fuck, man.
Right. They're like, every time you come back and we're lost, motherfucker, every night you talk about the burning bush. And he's like, yeah, but for the Bible version, let's just say there was a burning bush only one night.
Oh, my God.
See, look, I don't want to look like there was a burning bush every night.
See, look, they're always anointing oil and perfume. I mean, you could.
Yeah. That was so perfect, man. That little piece right there, because, I thought that there was not even one mention. How do you know?
But then how did religious people get so against it when it clearly doesn't? It certainly doesn't say anything against it.
It's a conspiracy with the Bilderbergers, man.
And with the Bilderbergers.
It all comes back to the Bilderbergers.
It's a fucking Illuminati, man.
Yeah.
Yeah.
They're the one.
I don't even know.
So I don't know this to be a fact, but I have to imagine at some point when Bibles were being printed that hemp was, I guess papyrus would probably be the number one back there, because mm-hmm. when it, the printing and all that shit,
used
that's a
hemp.
Good historical deal. Yeah. Well, the Chinese I know used hemp and cannabis type paper, but in Egypt and all those areas they used papyrus, which is made slightly differently, but I don't know how.
They had to have used it for rope. They had to. I mean, there's so many applications for it for clothing because it's soft when you know.
In the biblical
see, to area. Them it was probably so commonplace that yeah. it wasn't like to us. It's this discussion of like hemp and hemp because it's been like illegal and defamed and all that, you
right.
know, whatever, you know. But to them, it probably wasn't a discussion. It was probably like, yeah, this plant is perfectly helpful, so we're using it however the hell we can.
Of course you would use it, right.
It's right, like, it was common sense.
Right.
It was like, exactly, you know.
We know that this relieves pain and
right.
you know, it will actually cleanse a wound or whatever they, you know.
I don't think the ancient Egyptians had, like, marijuana discussions and debates. You
yeah.
know? It was just like...
Cleopatra right. is rumored, though, right?
Yeah, hey.
Really?
Yeah,
she's a stoner bunny.
She was smoking out.
She's a stoner bunny. Yeah,
I heard she was kind of hot, too.
Yeah.
All the hot chicks smoke, dude.
Yeah.
That's the truth.
Many?
Yeah, for sure.
Many. The interesting thing is many of the hot ones I meet, not so fucking, they're like...
Really?
That's nice.
Yeah.
They don't realize that.
You gotta come on a lift ride with me, bro.
I do... Maybe I'll do a ride-along, just like the fucking
cops. Do you get a bunch of girls hitting, like, little vape pens and stuff like that? I see all the cute girls hitting pens.
I say nothing.
Okay, fair enough.
He's not looking at ladies, right. Mike's not giving you up.
What happens at Lyft stays at Lyft.
I don't look in the rearview mirror at all. I mean, much. I'll turn around and, you know, say hi, but, you know.
Good answer.
I'm not paying attention, man.
Hey, people have
focusing on the road and doing your job.
Yeah, that's,
safety.
That's
respect
what I'm about.
That.
I'm about, you know, 100% of the people that get in my car, you know, and Lyft, make it home. 100%. Because if it was 99%,
yeah. Like, well, I guess it depends on it.
You'd
if,
be
you know,
worried.
If you got 45 years and 99%, you're still
not
pretty
bad.
You're still
yeah.
pretty
not bad.
Good.
Still pretty good. Yeah. I lost one. I don't know.
Yeah.
It happens.
I turned the corner. She didn't have the fucking door latched. Yeah. Hitting on a vape pen. No seatbelt.
It's her fault.
This plus this equals
what,
this.
What made you do yeah. Lyft instead of like Uber or whatever? Like
oh, it's a great just... story. Uber did not do well by me. I mean, you know, when you go to do Uber, you sign up a certain way, and then you end up going here in Phoenix. You got to go to this thing that's kind of like their office in it, but it's more like
right.
a DMV.
Yeah.
So you walk in there, it's very sterile. You know, you got to sign in, and you got these different stations you got to go to throughout this process.
Huh.
And they've done that in order to make it, you know, a smooth process. It's not smooth. It took 6 weeks for me to even, I went back to them after 6 weeks of waiting to be approved to find out that I was approved, but I was approved in San Antonio, Texas, driving a car with Arizona fucking plates, with an Arizona driver's license, issued insurance in Arizona. And I'm like,
whoa.
Okay, that's interesting. So I went to go and try and get it changed, and it was just a hassle. Well, here's the flip side of that, right?
Uh-huh.
I go to Lyft, and within 1 week, I have a mentor, within a couple days, actually, I have a mentor that calls me up, sets up an appointment. I go meet with this guy where he shows me everything. You know, there's a video that I got to watch, but he kind of like holds my hand and walks me through the whole thing. And then we take a drive. He takes me around the neighborhood, you know, just to see how I do. And
yeah.
he checks out my car, takes some pictures, and says, hey, congratulations, man. I'm going to approve you.
Wow.
And I'm still in contact with this guy. His name's Andrew.
That's cool.
Had him on a podcast. It's
really?
Coming, yeah. And he talked about ride sharing and what the difference has been made statistically and things like that. He's a really cool dude. So can you see the difference between Lyft and Uber?
Yeah, yeah.
Here are some of the other differences. Uber pays 80% to all their drivers. And that's it. 80%, that seems like a fair deal. Except that when you're dealing with Uber, you know, they say that, you know, hey, the tip is included. Well, there is no tip included. There's no tip, you know, unless somebody tips you. And Uber has done nothing to allow tipping in the app. Well, contrast that to...
Oh, so they don't even... There's yeah. not even a way to... Someone literally has
like
to
tip you. If they
want to
tip
cash.
You, it
yeah.
makes it more difficult.
They have to pull cash out, right?
Right.
Lyft, it's in the app. You know,
oh,
you'll be able
nice.
To tip $1, $2, $5, or
see,
choose your own.
See, that way at least
own.
You know they're thinking about
Dude,
the people
I
working
like
for
tipping
them.
Tipping people,
know?
Man.
Yeah, yeah,
yeah. Yeah, for sure.
Yeah.
People who think
you
shouldn't tip are silly fucking bitches, man.
Well, here's the other... Yeah, because... Not I'm you know I'm making what I make on each drive and then it makes a difference for me to have a little extra cash put in. But guess what, the girl that's you know working her ass off at Denny's, You know, she's making $2 an hour, if that. Right. I don't even know what they make. What, $2.35?
Yeah.
Fucked up, dude. Yeah. So she's really in a service industry, and if she does a good job, well, she does a good job or not, it's 20%.
And she takes the hit just because the food they sell is cheaper, so you're not going to get tipped as much because you tip based on percentage. So she works just as hard as a lady at, you know, Outback or, you know, Ruth Chris, you know, except there's just cheaper food, so she makes less, which I never, you know, it's the same job, you know?
Yeah, exactly. So I throw 20% at everyone, you know, all the time.
I tip more if I'm at, like, cheap diner places.
Yeah, exactly. I was just going to say
that. I always,
Yeah, because you're right. It's exactly what it is. You know, $5 for a $6, you know.
And they deal with more shit, too.
Yeah.
I'm sure.
Oh, God.
I'm sure they deal with more shit,
Yeah. You're not getting the upper regions of society.
No, no.
I try to go wherever I'm at. I try to be on the upper side of like 20 to something.
Yeah.
20 to 25 to.
I feel like a dick if I'm not.
Right.
Legit.
So I was tirading about the differences between Uber and Lyft, and you know, the final thing for me is that Lyft offers an opportunity for every driver to actually make more money. So they pay 80% as well. But if I work 30 hours and I have 10 hours or so in peak time, they'll give me back 10%. So they'll pay me 90.
Wow.
If I do 50 hours, same 10 hours of peak time, they'll pay me the full 100%. And I have not missed a week, dude. I do 60 to 70 hours a week on the app. I'm not necessarily driving all that time, but I'm on app. And I make 100% every time. And I'm telling you, it makes a difference.
And Lyft is the same way as like Uber, where you just log into the app whenever you want to work.
Yeah, exactly.
You make your own schedule. Yep. That's cool.
Yeah.
Kind of makes me wish I didn't get my DUI when I was younger and I could
work it. How long ago was that?
Yeah.
Dude, I got a DUI. Jesus, the first DUI I got in Chicago was when I was living out there and I was DJing at the nightclubs and was with these two girls and crashed my car into a rainbow colored pole in Boys Town of Chicago. Because the girl that I was dating at the time lived in like the gay neighborhood.
Thank you for giving us details that you don't have.
It was right by Wrigley Field is like Boys Town.
Yeah.
A lot of single girls in their 20s live out there, you know, whatever. And smashed the car right into the thing. It was a total rainbow colored pole, and I ended up having to pay for it. So every time I go back out to the Chicago, I'm like, I own that pole. Yeah. See that boy's pole? I own that pole. Motherfucker.
Me and then, the two bitches.
But that one, because Chicago is real lenient on shit like that, it really didn't affect me that much. But when I got a DUI here in Arizona, which that was like the never again DUI.
Yeah. I heard it's 10 grand right away. It's going to cost you at least that much.
I think probably in the long term. Yeah. It's crazy because I got it trying to do the right thing, if that sounds weird. Like I got it.
Doesn't sound weird at all from a bail bondsman.
Dude, this is what happened. I was doing a comedy show, and it was during like the Suns playoffs, you know, so nobody showed up to the show because everyone's watching the Suns game.
Right.
So you just bartender gets all the comics drunk, wasted, you know, and we end up going down to Mill partying and stuff like that. And I realize I'm too drunk to be driving home. So I'm right by a hotel. So I drive to this hotel and I try and check into the hotel and they didn't let me check in because I said I was too drunk. And I said, well, that's the reason why I want to check in and just go to sleep. So I don't have to drive home. They refused me. And I wasn't being obnoxious or, you know, it was just, they just could smell it on me. Yeah. And I remember kept saying like, well, that's why, you know?
Yeah.
So I called up a friend who lived relatively down the street. I was like, I could make it over there, you know, like, can I come over and crash at your place? Cause I didn't want to drive all the way back home. So I get out, I drive to her place and, didn't have my turn, you know, didn't have my lights on. When I pulled out.
That's a classic mistake.
Yeah. Get pulled over and, you know, like some time in Tent City and it sucked, you know?
Yeah. Sheriff Joe's not fucking, he's not a kind man when it comes to DUI, and it doesn't matter what your intentions were.
He's not a kind man regardless, but especially with DUIs. Yeah. I mean, you know, I'm not going to, you know, like that was definitely a stupid part on my part, but like the frustrating thing is I did try and do the right thing.
Sure. And was there a Lyft and Uber back then?
No. Happened? You know, what's funny is if there was, it would have been perfect because you don't have to pay at the time. So even if you didn't have the money for it, you could still get the ride home.
Yeah.
You know, because it takes it off your thing later on.
Right.
Whereas a cab, you could never do that with. Yeah. So that would have been an option for me. But this was like, was around when I first moved back from Chicago, so like 2006, maybe 2005.
That's 9 years ago, 10 yeah, years ago. Was, you should be all right.
Yeah, oh, now, yeah. Oh, yeah. Maybe. Well, now
you might be able to drive. Yeah.
Yeah. After 7 or 8 years, yeah, they fall off your record. Did you do all the breathalyzer?
Yeah, thing I still have to get the breathalyzer is the only thing I didn't do because I didn't drive for a while after that.
Oh, you got to do that for a year.
Yeah. So I, you know, that's the only thing left that I got to do, and then I'm done with it all.
I have. I know a guy, man.
I know a guy
from my bail from the bail bond.
Yeah. Well, yeah, so yeah, Jim, you used to be a bail bondsman, man.
I did. I am a former bail bondsman.
You've heard every story.
I mean, could you still put the badge on and go out there and do some fucking dog the bunny hunter shit?
You know, I still have the all of the costume.
Nice.
You got to bring it.
I don't know if I still am registered, but yeah, it would be a similar process to what we were just talking about for me to register again.
Right, right.
It's scary easy, man.
Dude.
See, and the hoops you have to jump through for other shit.
Did you guys see the guys that hit the Phoenix Chief of Police house? The
Yeah.
Bounty hunters?
Yes.
Did you see that?
No, I didn't.
So the story I heard from...
Let's see if I could pull it up on Facebook.
Oh, yes, you can, for sure. Oh, fuck yeah,
you can,
bro.
It's a big story, yeah.
Yeah, so while Mike's pulling this up, man, this is a good one, yeah. I heard allegedly that there was some dudes running around pretending that they were bounty hunters, which happens frequently in the bail bond industry. When I owned my bail bond company, all the time I would get people coming in, most of them legit as far as their paperwork goes. But again, it's scary easy to get that designation as a bounty hunter. So then the issue is the same thing in Arizona as it is with firearms. Scary, you know, like you can get them easy, but the responsibility that comes with them, you have no idea. Like if you don't really sit down and do your research or have someone who trains you in what you're doing. And this guy was pretending to be a bounty hunter. Was holed up or inside. Claiming that he was. This?
It turns out they went to the wrong home. The bondsman ended up targeting the home of Phoenix Police Chief Joe Yonner.
Took the wrong home to fuck with.
This is his wife recording it. Caught on this video is wife's cell phone.
At the house of Phoenix Police Chief Joe Yonner last night at around 10 o'clock. Phoenix police say 11 people from two different bail bond companies surrounded Chief Yonner's house, screaming at the chief to come out with weapons unholstered.
Police say the bondsmen were
actually. I will say this: it's awesome to see a police chief actually getting his home raided. How does it feel, motherfucker?
I don't know if the chief was the target specifically, or if the bond companies were a target.
Not fun,
and,
is it?
And sent there by someone. But what we do know is that.
Somebody's North in deep Star. Shit.
What we somebody's do now is that on somebody is
the fugitive they were looking for was at that location.
In the video, you can
what
see
we
the
do now. Wow, Facebook is to blame. With
lights pointing. I'm surprised that wasn't a shootout.
We should ban Facebook.
What's going on? That's when his significant other calls police.
We have some. I don't know if they're bounty hunters or what they are, but they just banged down our door and they're looking for somebody.
Police have arrested one person, the owner of the bail
that guy rocks.
Company, North Star Recovery.
Oh,
Brent
shit,
Farley
dude.
Is now facing charges of trespassing and disorderly conduct.
Wow. They knew the name of the individual who lived at the home, but they indicated that they did not put that together with the chief of police for the city of Phoenix.
Fuck.
Phoenix police.
Somebody should do that to Sheriff Joe.
I heard a rumor from the bail bond community about this one that this dude, so it turns out afterwards that the guy was a felon from Texas who was not supposed to have a firearm.
This guy
allegedly,
right here?
All of this is allegedly.
Wow.
A felon from Texas who was not supposed to have a firearm, and he was not a bounty hunter
that
registered in Arizona.
Wow.
And so there may or may not have been a different bail bondsman in Arizona who found out he was pretending and decided to make sure that the guy alerted the highest of authorities himself to the fact that he was pretending and said,
oh,
hey, man,
shit.
I need you to go get this guy for me. He's at this house and it's $50,000 bond and I'll pay you five grand and it's an easy pickup for you and it's a good one. And I don't know if all that conversation happened. However, I'm surmising a bunch of it. I'm totally making it up, actually.
That part you're doing
of the
a good
actual
job.
Conversation is fucking make believe, right? I'm making all of it up.
I was
so intrigued.
I was like, sold. As the guy's staring into his eyes, they decide to have a martini together. So doesn't have martini glasses. They go to what's the old time club fucking downtown that looks like Frank Sinatra would be hanging out in there?
Oh shit!
On Central, where all the attorneys and shit hang out.
On Central.
Yeah.
If it's a place where attorneys hang out, I've never been there for
yeah,
sure.
Yeah, the fake.
It's not Central. You've got to know it. It's Hulu. Like, it's been there forever, Hula. Man. No.
On Central.
South of Thomas.
I'm lost.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I've got to look it up, man.
He's got to
yeah,
look
so,
it up.
Saved by Google.
Nice.
For $1 million, Durant's.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Durant's is like, looks like Frank Sinatra's ghost is
all right,
alive
so,
in there.
So back to our conversation about what a fucking nightmare it was for you to get into a place.
So after all of the letters of intent and all that shit fell out, and just assume there was, or not assume, no. That there was a good 2.5 years worth of real big person adult fucking grinding it out work.
Yeah.
And getting punched in the face that all led to this point. So then I would go find buildings that looked to me like they qualified, and then I'd call the city of Phoenix and say, here's the address, and then they would rattle off what were the obstacles in our way. So through a process of, and then what I would have to do is say, can I have the address of this obstacle, and this obstacle? And then I would physically go drive there and see if that, whatever it was, a school or a, you know, church or whatever was in the way was still there. So I finally found a building where all of those things were gone. And then I had to, our building now that we're in over at Metro Center. And then I had to go back to the city and get all that shit changed in their pub. This is before I can even put in to get a hearing to get it zoned, because all the stuff is coming up when they punch in the address. It shows all these things are there.
Yeah.
So I had to put in an application to have all these other things changed that they're no longer businesses there.
Right.
Then we put in for the variance.
Wasn't there a school or some? They were claiming there was a school there?
Yeah, there was. In Metro Center, there is still a, I guess you'd call it a vocational or a technical high school.
That doesn't count.
Well, it's for college age kids, 17 to 22 years old, who, and there's no, ironically, no zoning laws or rules that keep us any distance from a college. I can be right across the street from.
There shouldn't
so
be.
These are college age kids that we're talking about, which was where our argument started with.
Right.
Then you add the other thing that the actual physical distance from us to the school was over the quarter mile that it was supposed to be in physical distance. However, the way the law was worded is that you measure from the outside wall of the dispensary to the property line of the school. Well, because the school was in Metro Center, the property line of the school was considered the parking lot right across the street from us.
Bullshit.
So they were saying that, so technically we were 450 feet from a school or whatever Jesus it was, 480 Christ. Feet. So yeah, there was so then when they put the sign
up. Was that
up
Kim front, Davis that was fucking working that one? right?
I may give her name later.
All right.
First name is Brenda.
Last name is Davis. Brenda.
Anyone want to step up?
Kim's sister.
Brenda. Fucking bitch. We'll call her Brenda M at this point.
All right.
Was the one who started to lead for the neighborhood and stuff. And then she got Metro Center involved, and it was started whipping everyone into a frenzy. But here's what started it was because of what they had to write on, you know, when you go for zoning, they put a sign up in front of your property saying, here's what these people want to get this zoned to do.
Right.
And so what it said on there was to have a medical marijuana dispensary within 1,285 feet of a school or whatever a quarter mile distance is. So these people are like, oh my God, they want to put this thing right next to a school, and they're flipping out. And then it was in an old kindercare building. So add insult to injury, and not that means jack shit to anyone other than anyone who's connected, somehow thinks we're giving poison to children.
Right. Somehow it's not. That's not what the function of the building is anymore.
Right. I mean, and
get over yourself, fuckers.
Yes, the ghosts of the children are not smoking weed there.
The place, the McDonald's across the street has given more poison to kids than
right, exactly.
Amen.
Thank you, brother. Thank you. Preach
absolutely
on.
Man. It's worse way shit. More poison in a Happy Meal, mama.
Not that I don't like Chicken McNuggets, but it's poison.
It's the truth. You know how much poison is in a Happy Meal, mama?
Yeah.
All right. So there was that. Yeah.
So then, so there was just this battle. So then we, at the original zoning hearing, there was all kinds of people opposed. We won anyway. Then they appealed it in the city of Phoenix. If you are a neighborhood association, you can appeal any zoning decision the way that I understand it. I'm not a zoning attorney, although I know many of them now. You can appeal any decision for $35.
What?
And then it goes to the Board of Adjustment, and they have a 7-person board vote on your future of your zoning.
Wow.
And so at this zoning, there were 8 of us. You know, on the dispensary side, yeah, there was my partner, our attorney, Nurse Heather and Ken were there from the fucking beginning.
Shut
and
up.
My mom and a couple of friends from New Mexico, couple of Nurse Heather's friends from New Mexico were nice. There to support us. And that was, and potential future investors is really why they were there.
Right.
If we won, then we'd had an opportunity to have some investors come in. So, there were over 350 opposition people opposing their people to oppose it. You're talking about many people. I mean, more than 15 or 20 carrying small children, and they all had giant red stickers on their chest. And wow. This lady, Brenda M., got up and basically started talking and didn't stop, and thank God no one liked her anyway, not even her side, and so for a lot of obvious reasons to everyone but her.
Some people, the lights just don't go on,
righteous
man.
Doesn't work. Yeah, I have to remind myself of that sometimes.
Some people just are not self-aware at all,
right? So it even with that, we win 4-3.
Nice.
The vote, even
nice.
With logic and science and the law and everything on our side, there was still 3 people
that were
who couldn't make it right in their head. Yeah, I'm like, oh.
Just disagreed with logic.
Right. So there were 3 people who still found exception. Anyway, we ended up getting in there, man. And and then, you know, I'm thinking, well, there's been people dropping by the construction site and stuff as we're building. And then construction went over time and over budget and all that crazy stuff. And all of the dirty contractor stories.
Oh, Jesus. I remember that.
And so including the thinking. Yeah. I mean, so the other part of this, while all this stuff is going on, just a side note, like a footnote in history, is that everybody, you know, keep in mind my shitty $650 a month one bedroom apartment that we're both living in and fighting all these. And these people are picturing us going back to our Pablo Escobar mansion,
right?
In our fucking Bentley and shit, right? Like, yeah. we really kicked their ass, dude.
Right. Not quite how it works.
Oh,
gold
no,
rings,
man.
And gold chains,
right.
And gold teeth.
And what we were doing was going back, figuring out how can we keep the certificate and move this thing forward and try to still.
Turn
it into something that contributes to the patient. So, contrary to popular belief, it's really not the big, bad, evil dispensary owners. And they, you know, there's many, many, many dispensary owners that came from blue collar backgrounds that, do we get lucky? Fuck yeah.
Yeah.
Somebody had to get lucky. It was a lottery.
Yeah.
So, that's not your fault that that's the way the rules were set up.
Right.
I played inside the fucking rules
everyone
else did, man. Yeah. And you ask me, do I feel bad or guilty or whatever? Absolutely not. I worked as hard, if not harder,
it's
than
admirable. It's actually really admirable. And I think that, there are always going to be people that are going to, you know, hate and judge and whatever. And thank God for them, because they have an opinion. They have a polarizing opinion. And what that means is that those opposers are always going to cause those supporters to want to support more.
Absolutely.
And they become really our proselytizers because other people are listening to them and going, you're not using logic. You're not thinking this through. You're just being an antagonist and an asshole.
Right.
And now we have more supporters. Thank God for them.
Man, it finally.
I know how to way to fucking turn shit around, right?
Absolutely. Well, yeah. I will say now, you know, coming up on 2 years of being open, that what we've run into is the neighborhood and the community and everybody has actually, I wouldn't say all of them have gotten behind us, but I, you know, we were looking at some zoning for concentrate stuff and some other things for our cultivation. And when we were getting letters of support, I did not find a single person that would oppose us. And in fact, I got apologies from people in the neighborhood who said, I apologize. I'm sorry that I fought you on this.
That's cool.
You guys have been a good business. You've run a clean business. I haven't noticed you. You've been good neighbors. You've been good for the community.
That's
and
awesome.
I hope that you never move.
That's what I'm talking about.
And that is from, you know.
There's a place you should post up that stuff online. You know,
Sure.
Yeah, absolutely. Oh, yeah, we should
You know
that
what I'm saying?
Post some of those letters. Yeah.
You know, and then you've got your, you've been open for 2 years, and the name of your dispensary again is
Horizon the Health Center.
Horizon the Health Center.
Horizon THC.
Yeah. .com.
Oh, that's
right?
What I didn't put that together. That's,
that's
very clever.
Well, again, as part of our integrity with the neighborhood, we did things to, you know, some people go, oh, well, you're being a sneaky bitch. Well, maybe I'm being a sneaky bitch, or maybe I'm trying to work with the community in that we're trying to get a name that doesn't offend anyone, as, you know, as clean as possible. There it is, Horizon, the Health Center. That's what's on our sign. So if you, when someone sees something that's clean like that, even if they're opposed to it, and we can still answer the phone, Horizon THC, and you know,
exactly.
So it's sort of all encompassing is what it is.
And look, you've got all these quotes in here. Bad 1812 says very friendly atmosphere with employees who make you feel quite comfortable. I mean, and I haven't been to your center yet. I'm looking forward to going, but I gotta tell you, man. This is just a really clean, well-made site. It looks very professional.
Thank you.
You know, and it not the seedy, like, you know, Mexican that I used to buy weed from when I was a kid in California. You know what I'm talking about?
That would have been me.
But shout out to him, too. Shout out to him.
Hey, man, I miss you.
Mad love to you, bro. Yeah. His name was Juan.
Right. We just evolved, man.
Exactly.
Shout out to the cavemen, too.
Yeah, man.
We use fucking guns now.
That's awesome.
And that's cool, though, that they're planning on redoing Metro Center, too, for you.
Yeah.
That's got to be exciting for shit going on with you over there.
It's very exciting, man. And that's another interesting transition. Like I've talked about, there's places in the neighborhood where I'll go eat and everybody's like, yeah, and then there's places I go and they're like, they'll just kind of turn the head and
because they know you own a dispensary.
Yeah,
really?
Yeah, you get the love. And
what places are those? I want to hear that.
Well, I'll say the where we get love is the Irish pub over there.
Well, go figure.
Tim Finnegan's, man.
For
me,
want
that medicinal shamrock.
You know what? They're super cool when we go in there, man.
That's cool.
It's for somebody who doesn't really get all excited about anything, their fish and chips are fucking kick ass.
Nice.
I eat it at least
like fish and chips
once or twice a week. So those guys are super friendly to us, man. They always should give us, you know, just make us feel welcome when we're in there.
Definitely got to plan that lunch out, man.
Yeah.
I'll go there.
Well, Jason's Deli's right across the street there. We give those guys a lot of business too, and they show us love. And
you'd think every restaurant would love a dispensary.
I would think
that
for sure. Absolutely.
I mean, it's a cliche to say, but it's the fucking truth.
I haven't, you know what? I haven't personally talked to any business owners, but there we'll run into someone from the neighborhood, from the zoning battle or something that'll be sitting out in front of one. So I'd say less the business owners. They just want to run their business.
Sure.
And at this point, I think they understand the value of having an occupied business there versus not
just anything.
Having,
they should be happy there's something there.
There were definitely some
at that point you can't like pick and
some real benefits to having a full, you know.
Yeah.
So right. here's a crazy story. So when we first start, so almost ready to get the dispensary open. We're under construction doing the tenant improvements in there and stuff.
Right.
And so what I started doing was there was a spot between the two buildings where homeless, you know, people who didn't have shelter would go hang out and stay for the night.
Yeah.
It was just a kind of a sheltered place. So I just started walking over there and I said, hey, man, in about 30 days, you're going to have to be clear of here, because in about 6 weeks, we're going to be open and there's just no way, man. So we started having those conversations. All of them were super cool. And then there's one guy who I arrested during my bail bond thing. When I arrested him, he's like 6'6".
Jesus Christ.
Super flaming gay dude. And at the time I arrested him.
This is getting better.
At the time I arrested him, he was about 300 pounds, man. Oh, just man. A large, grimace-looking type fellow. And he went not the easy. We arrested him a few times, I think. Oh, and
he was a returning customer.
Is it?
Man, and in a at a place where we really never try, where we really avoided that. It sounds fucking crazy, but at that place we avoided. That was our business model, was to be friendly and avoid arresting people. Walk them into court and help them get their their bonds quashed and things like that. Yeah. So it was a different business model altogether. This guy, and there's still some people who just, they refuse. And so this cat was one of those. And so I ended up, I walked out back of the building to, you know, have my morning conversation with whoever the shelterless people were out there. And this dude stands up and he's like skinny as a rail. He looks like Manute Bol or something.
Shit.
And he's like, I recognize you. Where you from? And I'm like, at the time, I don't remember. I had my head shaved sometimes and not during the bail bond thing. And I'm like, I don't know you. And he's like, I know you.
Oh, shit.
And I'm like, and then he's standing there with like two women, and they're all clearly, you know,
strung out.
I shouldn't say clearly. Apparently. have had some interactions with some hardcore drugs in around that time frame.
Right.
The recent here and now. And so, And so, I'm like, Larry? And he's like, goes taking off running down the street.
Oh, shit.
And it was like, I'm like, I don't even know if I can arrest that dude anymore. Well, I definitely couldn't. I didn't have him out on bond, and no one that I knew of did, but possibly someone he knew did. So yeah,
that's all it took, man. Was your reputation had him flying down the street.
Well, and you never know, man.
Dude, you never know, man.
never a dull day at the office in that job.
Right, yeah. Absolutely not. So the so now the dispensary's open, man, and all of the credit to everything that you're saying as far as it's clean, it's friendly, and two of the biggest things that we get. The other thing is the amount of clean information. You don't hear in our place, that like we know our shit.
Makes a big difference.
Yeah, it does.
That's important. You know,
it makes all the difference experts, in the world.
For sure.
Those are the worst things you could ever hear at a place like that. You know,
we know what it smokes like. We know what it smokes like. We know what it tastes like.
Yeah.
We know the medicative effects of it. If you want to talk about terpenoids, man, we'll sit and talk to you about terpenoids and cannabinoids and all that shit. Yeah. Lipids, how to separate them, debates on BHO versus CO2 versus salt, whatever, man. We're nerds there. We love having those conversations.
Yeah.
In fact, I talk to the staff about stuff like that, man. You just can't believe you get paid to talk about
it's unbelievable, like, man.
It's fucking awesome.
Here's one of the things that I'm wondering about, because that's an amazing past and an incredible now. What's next? Like, what do we see coming down the pike? I mean, I know we've got some expos coming up and things like that, but for Arizona specifically, are we gonna get recreational use? Are we gonna get it in the next year? Are we gonna get it in the next 2 years? And then, okay, now we knock this domino over. What's the next domino? So will it be Texas or will it be New Mexico or like where? And then finally, how the fuck do we get it legal nationwide?
Right.
I think on that one, I think Arizona for sure will go recreational. I don't see how it can't. I think that this state has always been kind of had an underground vibe that's very positive towards marijuana that people aren't really aware of until they come out here. But I think people in Arizona see the money going into Colorado and say, why the hell aren't we cashing in on that? Even if you don't smoke, like, you would want to cash in on that.
Yeah,
seems common sense. And I think nationally, I think it's going to work out the same way it worked out with, like, gay marriage. I think one day you're just going to wake up and some decision was made and all of a sudden, the vote You know, like right. really, I don't think it's going to be, I don't think it's going to be some long drawn out debate. I think it's going to be a very quick thing where you're just like, all of a sudden, like, oh, we're done with that nightmare now. Okay.
Yeah.
Then the rest will be just working out the details, like the technicalities of it afterwards.
And there's a lot of people with big names that are involved in the current lobbying for medical marijuana for the declassification, right, of class one to class three, and making marijuana a legal medical, you know, viable medicine, right?
Yeah.
I would be surprised, altogether.
Right?
I would be surprised if it takes 5 years. You know, 5 years. And I used to never say that. I used to be like, within 10 years.
Are we talking federally?
Federally. Okay, got it. You know, I'd be surprised if it even takes like 5 years, you know, because even if you look on the Republicans, they're starting to become like it's less, you know, even the ones that are against it aren't even that against it that they used to be, you know?
Yeah.
Like, I'll tell you what blew my mind away was the interview I had at Emerald Dispensary the other day. I said to her, I was like, when I was 18 years old and I started working off at Trails, you know, Trails, the smoke shop.
Right.
If the future me would have told the past me back then, like, you'll be wearing like a shirt and tie at an interview and like having these like serious discussions in a serious job interview for something on that, I would have been like, get the fuck out of here. You know, like, blown away, you know? And I told her that, you know, like the things that we were talking about that pertain to the job and, you know, stuff like that, it was an unreal. I mean, I've had these discussions before for jobs and stuff like that, but it's always unreal and kind of blows my mind away that these are even topics you're having. Because when I was 18, like I said, cops used to park outside of just a smoke shop and mess with you. You know, you would get like,
oh fuck.
When I worked at Trails, you would honestly, my mom's a court reporter, and she had a cop come into her office for something, you know, and the cop recognized a picture of me in her office and said he works at Trails. And she said, how do you know that? And he was an undercover guy that would go in there to try and learn the new lingo and stuff like that.
Yeah.
And that just doesn't happen anymore, which just, I mean, that alone shows you how far things have come, which if you look at that and how it's changed, I think that the rest of the change that needs to happen is going to happen so fast because it's just been building so much over time that it's just going to blow a gasket and just be like, prohibition one day. That's how...
Today's media too, because we're able to leverage media in such a way where you can make a much bigger difference. So, I mean, there's all these activists that are involved, from Joe Rogan to, you know, all these comedians that are involved.
George Zimmer from Men's Warehouse.
Oh, dude.
He's
like legitimate business owners.
But like guys like him are extremely important for that, because the guys that you would never think, the guys that you're like, what? And then you're kidding. Oh, okay, cool. Those are the most important people to come out of the shadows and say something. You know,
former mayors and senators and people, I mean, people that I know within, you know, one degree of separation, and you know, those guys that are 420 friendly, dealing with anxiety or something else, and are able to function and use it as a medical solution. But you know, beyond that, I mean, the media has changed in its or I think the internet has changed. Netflix has changed everything, right? So you can go online and you can watch this movie called The Culture High, which talks a lot about what we're involved in talking about right now.
Yeah.
And that's a great movie because it talks about the legal piece of it and the medical piece of it and a lot of the other stuff that we've already talked about here. I recommend go and watch that movie, man. If you're curious about, you know, cannabis, medical marijuana.
Well, that shit with like the internet and stuff, that shit changed it, because you realize that you're not alone out there. You're like, wait a minute, everybody else is thinking the same thing. So hold on, maybe the bullshit is coming from the other side. It's telling us how bad this is.
Yeah.
You know,
with no real data.
Right. There's safety in numbers, because you realize that there's, you know, what's the big deal? Why is it? And more people are like online saying the same thing. So then collectively, the whole country kind of starts to go like, yeah, what is the big deal? I mean,
Exactly. Well, the thing is that the Edge podcast is really about taking conversations and moving them forward.
Yeah.
So what we have is an old narrative. It was the way that they used to say, you know, marijuana is a gateway drug. Gateway to what? You know, nobody ever qualified that. Yeah. Nobody ever qualified it. Right. Nobody ever gave medical, like no fucking research. It was just a great, buzzword.
What about on the flip side of that, how marijuana... If you're going to say it's a gateway drug, on the flip side of that, what about how marijuana has kept people like me off of like pharmaceuticals?
Yeah,
you know, absolutely. Like it was the opposite of a gateway drug for me because I could smoke marijuana. I'm way less likely to ever need something like painkillers or Xanax or any of those pharmaceuticals, you know, so that going to what you said, it's
exactly,
you know,
and pharmaceuticals are much more dangerous
for sure
than heroin.
Oh.
You know, cocaine, meth, they're all terrible.
Some
put together.
Of them are the same molecule.
Yeah,
as
exactly
heroin.
The same. Yeah.
Some of them are the same molecule as heroin.
They're true. Opiates, man. It's, they are. Yeah, no doubt. It's a trip. So, but the future that we have politically here, or at least the battle that's been ongoing locally, has been, you know, it's highlighted now, I think, globally. We're starting to see, you know, there are other countries that have completely wiped out all illegalized drugs.
The UN just the other day, they said they're considering decriminalizing. They said they want to focus more on it as a health problem rather than as a crime problem.
As a criminal problem, yeah. I forget who it was that said it, but he's, you know, they asked the question, said, yeah, you know, when a young person smokes marijuana, you know, you don't necessarily want a young person to do that, but, you know, it could be a problem. Maybe it's a problem of rebellion, but is it a criminal problem?
No.
You know, that's the question. Or is it just a growing up problem? Or maybe it's not a problem at all. Maybe it's just, you know, a kid, you know, working it all out.
It's like if a kid, it's like, you know, I looked at my first Playboy magazine when I was like, what, 12 or 13 years old. And yeah, you know, ideally you don't want that, but like, did I turn out to be some fucked up? No, you know, like, like it's a natural, like, you know, like pot's a natural fucking thing, you know, like
titties and beer,
you know, you're going to be exposed to it eventually. You know?
Right, titties and weed.
Titties and weed.
But sorry,
that's a podcast show right there.
Oh my Lord. Titties and weed.
All right, man. You're coming back, right, Ben?
Hey.
For that podcast, sold. You're going to have to beat people off of that one.
I know, man.
That
happens. Phrasing.
See what I did?
That happens to be my specialty in life, is titties and weed.
You have to beat people off of that one.
We'll leave that to them.
That's your tagline for it, actually. Titties and weed. We're going to have to beat people off of this one.
We're going to have to beat people off of this. Yeah.
You're going to have to be my copy guy, man. Yeah. You just write my copy for me, dude.
I will.
That's awesome.
So when is it up for election in Arizona? This next year,
next
right?
year,
this
coming 2016, year,
2016.
Yeah.
I think.
Are
it's
we going
go.
Recreational? I mean, look,
I believe it is.
I'm gonna post this, and you know, in a week or so, and that's one of the things that I want to make sure that people do is that, you know, when it comes up on the ballot, man, cast your vote. Like, no kidding, cast your vote.
Vote. Yeah.
And, you know, a lot of things will change. I'm pretty sure that if we follow the model that, you know, that Colorado has done, that we're going to, you'll be able to walk into any dispensary with a driver's license and you know, go to the recreational side and get what you need.
Sorry to interrupt, Ben. This is a really important thing for every single fucking person out there to keep in mind. I was one of those people back in the day that really believed that my vote didn't matter. I've, for the most part, have pretty much been consistent with voting anyway. However, I really was not aware of the impact of my vote. Yeah. I did it because of my civic duty and
especially
because
locally.
People died for it and fucking, right. you know, yeah. our forefathers yeah. fought
yeah,
for
yeah,
it.
Yeah.
I figured, man, if they thought it was that important, it seems like it's a little
it's
broken
national
these days.
Duty, right?
But yeah. I will tell you, through developing relationships with different city officials, county, state, federal, different, you know, politicians and different House of Representatives people and all the different people in government. If you knew how many people, especially on a county and state and city level, win their fucking elections by 12 votes.
Oh
my God.
By 36 votes. Wow. Shit like that. So if you think your fucking vote don't matter, crazy. I'm telling you that like this was this, like these were people were, I don't have the specific historical examples, but there was a couple of politicians that I was having a conversation with. And this lady was telling me, you know, specifically about your vote matters kind of a thing. And she was saying in this election on this day, this person won by 12 votes. And on this, I mean, she was naming
holy
specific
shit,
examples of historic. It's all the
but
data's out there.
It goes to show a lot of times people, when they think of elections, they think of like the presidential election.
Right.
That's the only thing that's on their mind. Which, and that's
that's the one that's actually rigged.
It gets. Exactly. And it gets the most attention.
Right.
But the one that affects your life the most is actually local elections.
Your local elections.
You
this is a vote for vote. This isn't an electoral college like it is for president. This is a fucking vote for vote. So it does matter. Your vote is one, you know, ding on our side.
What exactly is the law that's up for it? Is it basically making it like Colorado or
the interesting thing is there's a debate and this is going to go.
I've heard people on Facebook
Fuck yeah, there's two. So there's two groups lobbying to get their own laws passed right now. There's one group which is backed by, or I shouldn't say backed by. There's one group that wrote the law, and they've done the majority of laws in other states, called MPP, Marijuana Policy Project.
Right. Okay.
There's another group who has a somewhat conflicting, and definitely voter-wise has a conflicting law that they would like to see get passed instead of the
MPP,
one, which they claim is, the MPP one is very heavily in favor of dispensaries and dispensary owners and creates a monopoly there. And that it only allows for, it does allow for six plants to be cultivated personally, but there are some, I guess, some prosecution type options in there if you have it illegally and you're doing illegal things. Because the concern was this last round, all the compassion clubs that got open and all the people that were doing things illegally.
Right.
So there's two groups. Basically, one is saying we want more freedom and more liberty, and we want to be able to grow fucking giant gardens in our backyard. And which I, you know, good luck getting that through. It's a lot more free medicine for people, and it's very idealistic, but there's no money backing it, and there's, you know, just the things that I can see of the two. So the other one is Arizonans for, I want to get this right. Okay,
no problem.
Do you actually, can you look it up on
no problem.
That just seems to me, though, that it's America, of course that's the way it's gonna head with, I mean there's goods and bads to it, but like, you know, there's pros and cons just like that with anything, but that just seems like, well, duh, this is how America is with everything, you know?
Yeah, well, I think that's a big part of it. I mean, you know, go ahead.
Arizonans for Legalization of Cannabis is...
sounds good to me.
...the other group. I fucking love that there's people getting out and taking responsibility for their community and writing laws and doing all of those things. And so I get less involved with the pissing contest between the two. Yeah, they have their, there's,
well, what side do you personally think you, I mean, do you,
I personally fall on the dispensary owner side, sure. Obviously on, as far as the, again, as someone who, there are some things that are written into the laws that will specifically call first mover's advantage. So for all of the things that
first
Mike mentioned,
first mover's advantage.
Right. So back when I was sitting in front of people's investors and everyone else was too embarrassed to ask for money or say that they were going to do a medical marijuana dispensary because it sounded like you were going to be a fucking princess when you grow up. No one wanted to say that shit out loud back then. So, you know, I was willing to go out and be embarrassed like the fat guy at the gym who's willing to bust through and two years later, all shredded.
I'm that fat guy at the gym.
But on your way to shredded, brother. That's the difference, right? You busted through. How much weight have you lost, Ben?
When I started working out, I lost like 90 pounds.
Damn. Right, you know? Yeah. Wow, man.
Right.
Yeah,
so,
yeah.
But you fought through that
to
get to a different thing, you know? And it's that. So anyway, there are some of the reasons I back it is because, there are some favorable things written in there for the current dispensaries that are still there. The new law may even like disband dispensaries or something like there was.
That's ridiculous.
I haven't read through the other one, to be honest with you. It's, and I'm not bagging on them. I hope that they're, you know, I just don't think there's enough money and enough cohesion and enough teamwork on that side. I see a lot of infighting. I see a lot of people arguing with themselves. For me, I'll sign both initiatives to get, you know, I think that's honestly the smart thing to do.
Let's support it all.
Yeah, is to just get one on the ballot. Let's
get it,
you know,
get it going. Yeah. Get it going. Yeah.
But to say fuck you against anyone who's trying to get this plant legalized and trying to get it to patients and people who, you know, there's a lot of people who are saying, well, the dispensary owners are keeping the prices up. That's total bullshit.
Yeah.
They're not, there's no one that wants the prices to be, I mean, yeah, they have to be in a certain, you can't have them where, you know, linoleum floor is now because no one's, you know.
So those people basically kind of want it to be like Oregon, right?
Right. Where it's just.
There's two.
A free for
all. Correct me if I'm trying to understand the way you're putting it. The two groups in Arizona are kind of like, one group is for things being more like how it is in Oregon, as the other group is more for things being like how they are in Colorado, right?
Is right.
Kind of.
And so
right.
How it is okay. in Oregon is more of a grower state.
And it's
how
like it, trading and yeah.
Yeah, and yeah. then and then in Colorado, it's more of a dispensaries.
Yes.
Yes. Yeah, state regulated. The dispensaries right. work with the state, so yeah. you've got
I think that does good for the state though yeah. too. If you see, you know,
it does. I mean, agree. It puts so much money into yeah. you know the school systems and everything. Like no kidding, better than. I think better than the lottery does.
Yeah.
Well, you know what? A lot of things too, man, is that one side of it is that when you have all of this quote unquote free medicine, you also have people that are free to do whatever the fuck they want to it, including not test it or not allow you to test it. And
yeah,
so,
exactly.
you know, if you're buying it privately, man, there's people who will put Kool-Aid in their nutrient deals jeez. To make
they
it taste
it.
Sweeter.
Mint it, pepperminting it.
Yeah. All yeah. kinds of yeah. stuff, yeah. man. Yeah, so it's like there's so many different sides. I'm not here to convince anybody on any one of the sides. Read the two initiatives,
yeah.
see
yeah.
which one speaks to you, and then vote for that one. But my suggestion is sign both of them, man. Let's get legislation out there. Yeah.
I think that's smart.
Because the other thing about the recreational side of it that people don't think about that I've run into many times is like, for instance, my dad was here for a convention for his business, and there was a bunch of other people there, and one of the gentlemen that was speaking at it had this crazy like burning like a fibromyalgia type or a neuropathy type pain in his feet where he could barely stand. You could see the man was in great physical pain. And if we had a recreational law here, I could have just gone to my dispensary and grabbed something for him and brought it back and said, hey, man, take a little bit of this Rick Simpson oil or, you know, take a puff on this. And he would have been fine.
Yeah.
But the guy wouldn't even touch CBD oil. I tried to get him some straight CBD oil.
Yeah.
He wouldn't touch it because he was so terrified that he was breaking the law. That's and ridiculous. He didn't know. And he's here from Texas where there's, you know, so.
Texas is crazy with their
They're coming along and they're trying to figure it out and they're trying to, but the problem is with Texas is it's almost like a religious, you know, allowance.
Yeah.
Like if this is part of your religion, then okay. Kind of thing.
Yes.
But at least they got that, you know?
Yeah. And,
so there are a lot of people that are joining that church, dude.
I think
I'm that religion in Texas.
all my friends from like out of state, they're very surprised when I tell them, and other people back it up. They're very surprised to hear that Arizona is a smoking state.
Right.
You know, like when I bring them out to, you know, smoke shops out here or just, you know, they're very impressed and very, you know, like, wow, I never would have thought that. And that's why I think that people will be very surprised with how Arizona goes in the not too distant future.
We're kind of, you know, men with a mission, right? I mean,
absolutely.
And you've been at this for how many years now?
Oh, about going on 6 years.
6 years. That's an investment of life. You know, that's six years, man. You know, I've been at this, maybe a year.
Wow.
So, you know, and my story
is... Kick-ass job here, too, by the way, man. I said it last time that we were in here.
Well, I've been at this for 3 months, but what I... Yeah, and thank you for that. But what I've been at is advocating for marijuana for the last year.
Right.
And just talking about it and sharing the, you know, that... Actually, I started sharing that movie. You know, the culture high, and
you said you started off like against it at first.
And I injured my back in 2000, and I've taken just about everything I can, Percocet, et cetera, you know, and each time I did and had to change the dose or up the dose. And then the next thing, you know, I'd get the jitters or I would, all the stuff that goes with, right. Taking those hard drugs. And then, I found out that it was legalized here in, it's October of last year, so 2014, and then that's when I became a card holder, and I still have pain, but it's manageable, and it's nothing more than a hit off my vape pen, and I'm good.
Nice,
wow.
See? You know, I'm an actual patient.
I just had a meeting Sunday, a couple days ago, with a guy who his religious background is Mormon. Mm-hmm. And he was a similar situation to you, extreme chronic pain. Was shot 20 years ago in the stomach with a high-powered rifle. Ooh. And affected it. Like, the bullet disintegrated on the way in and just basically, he still has metal pieces in him and stuff, and his back's messed up, and he's a construction guy and has all the injuries that go with it. And,
But because of the religious consideration, he wanted to talk, you know, sit and talk. And then he just basically said that he'd been doing that for 20 years. And he said, I'd get to the point like where, you know, I'd roll out of a Vicodin and then I'd go back to my doctor and I could tell that I'd start developing a tolerance. And I'd say, hey, I want a fentanyl patch now. And he'd give me a fentanyl patch.
That's the worst.
Yep. And I go to the next one and the next one and the next one. And he said, I'd rotate through like four or five different ones. And he started talking about just the flat line of your life and your consciousness and how it's just below
it. Just it, norm. It feels like shit.
Yeah,
you know, there the fog that I used to wake up with, lack of motivation. I mean, now we're talking about prescribed drugs.
All the stuff they say that weed does to you,
right?
Prescribed shit.
Right.
Was doing all those things to me. And today, when I, you know, I mean, we spoke to Joyn earlier, and like I think we're pretty high functioning.
When are they gonna have it? When are they gonna?
I do say so myself, right?
When are they gonna have a movie come out called Prescription Madness? that's what I want to know. When's the movie about pills coming out?
This is the idea, man. So we all got to sign the NDA again, because we're going to go ahead and produce that motherfucker.
Prescription Madness.
Prescription Madness.
Pharma Magic. Pharma Madness.
Yeah. Pharma Madness. Fucking wow. Pfizer. Oh, my God. That's hilarious. Yeah.
And it would be accurate. It wouldn't be like a lie. It'd be like, no, that fucking the shit makes you mad. Like,
it fucking kills people.
Right.
Man.
Well, the last I heard, every single mass shooting in the last 15 years was linked.
Yep.
The one common thread was antidepressants.
Yeah.
The shooter was either on antidepressants or had recently been on antidepressants.
I read a lot of stuff about that.
Had a history of them.
I want to grab the yeah, dude.
And
I
they couldn't
get
laid.
Statistics out.
They had a hard time getting laid.
So the was it Klebold and that other
keep
kid?
Keep me away from the antidepressants, then.
Yeah.
Because I got one of the two, brother.
Yeah, we gotta change. We gotta do something to change.
Please,
that.
Yes, please.
There's no reason why that should be.
So the the next thing we're going to start fighting for is legalized prostitution.
There we go.
I'd just like a young lady to come smoke a joint and
We're making it happen. We're going to make this happen.
I just want to hug.
Friends don't let friends go.
I just want to.
I think we could work out a hug for you, bro.
I think we can work on this.
I know a girl.
I'm a snuggly guy.
I know a girl. Dude, you're a handsome dude, man. I'm sure you're pulling plenty.
Seriously
not. That's not that is definitely not a joke. And it's mostly because my internet game fucking blows.
You know what though? Here's the thing. You do not need internet game with online dating stuff. You just need to establish that you are not a serial killer and that like you're fairly normal. All you have to do, Jim, is just don't be a lunatic. Just establish non-lunatic behaviors in the conversation, and the pussy gets wet.
My boys was saying that too, man. Was like, dude, just go sit at a fucking bar, take a book, and just sit there and fucking read. Incredible human beings.
What if we hooked you up with all the crazy comics?
Right.
God damn, dude. It would definitely be that would be a reality show for the ages.
Right.
That lady is appears to be very attractive. Yeah,
I know the type I know the type of girls you like.
She's really cool too, like super cool.
I'm telling you, let us make you a profile page on OkCupid.
Yeah, buddy.
And we'll even say, have you ever seen where like these lovey dovey things where like some mother's son will be like, my mother, you know, needs to date somebody, so I'm making the profile page for her.
Yeah. Right.
Let us do that for you.
Yeah, okay. It'll be 100. Yeah, I'm even more.
Are you down
of a
for that, Mike?
Transparent and honest that way.
Okay.
If you guys want to do that's fine.
I'll be on. I'll be like, I'm Jim's friend, you know, and he's looking for love. He's a dispensary owner. Well, you know.
So yeah, and then
you can answer the questions and stuff like that. Yeah. But we'll make the profile page.
Yeah, totally,
right?
Totally.
Right.
That'd be awesome.
And we'll maintain the page, you know, and we'll set you up on dates. Is that cool?
There can't be any crazy.
No, I'm not. No. We're not going to be out to like fuck you over. Like we're gonna do our
this
best.
This is gonna
to
be legit, man.
We'll
this is
legit.
Gonna be totally legit.
This isn't like a prank thing. We're not.
This
you know,
is yeah, and it's gonna
maybe once
there's,
we'll do that.
So I gotta ask a question. I mean, So is this endeavor? What's the end of this endeavor? So are we just trying to get Jim laid, or are we like
no? Let's get him a girl.
Trying
you want
to
a girl,
get him
right?
a real legitimate girlfriend.
Both. He wants to get laid anyway.
I don't know if I want a girl yet.
Okay,
you just want to get your.
So this might just be like let's get Jim laid.
Okay.
I mean, we could do that.
You know what? It's I'm open
I'm open to a girl.
You know, that's not that weird. You'd be surprised how many people say that shit on, you know, like, that's not that, you
it's
know.
Not. It's really right. not. But, well, you know, at the same time, you know, you got to be straight with the girl.
Well, too. What if well, we just right. said he's looking for a date? He's looking, you know, I'm looking to date a girl and see where it goes, right?
I'm definitely, my primary concern is not focused on finding a relationship.
That's why we're fine. Oh.
Right. But I mean, I'd like for me to end up in one. However, if that was, like, I'm not saying, fuck no, I don't want that. I would never turn away a fucking, like, super hot, awesome, supportive woman. Right.
Who would? Based on principle alone.
Would you let us start setting you up on some dates at Stand Up Scottsdale?
Oh, dude.
Yeah, fuck yeah.
We
got
to tell the story.
Okay.
After this. So we got to get him on the mic, and then he tells what happened.
Yeah.
Like the next night.
Right. Yeah.
That's awesome.
Howard may shout it out even.
Maybe. Okay. What if we did this? What if we made the profile? We set you up on, you know, some dates
we're
with
totally
girls or
setting
whatever,
up a whole new show right now.
At Stand Up Scottsdale, you know, because you know you're comfortable there. You know, it's a cool place to bring it. I used to bring filthies there all the time. You know, like you could do that.
I'm gonna be taking you my filthy.
I banged girls in that office before. You know, like dreams.
Have you? Fucking stud, dude. I've been in that office many times, but the only person I was in there with was Howard and the barbecue guy.
Oh, I've had Ricardo and Dietrich catch me doing some scoundrel stuff at that club.
Shit, dude.
I bet Ricardo was part happier of the about record. It than Dietrich was.
That's Dietrich funny. Is creepy. Dietrich was like, Dietrich oh, would shit, like watch dude. You, you know, and you'd like. Yeah, Dietrich would, you know. That's a whole other podcast, though.
That's amazing.
So I'm going to do this.
We're at 2 hours, believe it or not.
Okay. Wow.
Yeah, normally we do 90 minutes, but I just lost track of time because we're
talking. Well,
I had fun.
If you're down, I'm down with that.
Oh, absolutely. Dude, this is happening.
Absolutely. We're doing
exchange
this.
Exchange info?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay, good.
For sure.
All right.
Well, listen, guys, thank you for coming in. And,
I had a great
and
time.
Thank you for sharing, like, everything you shared. And, dude, you're funny. You really are. Go, you know, catch him at Stand Up Scottsdale. Catch him at Stand Up Scottsdale. He'll be the one that is dragging girls away so that they can meet Jim.
My reaction to that would be what some people put on their Facebook profiles. Well, I'll say it's complicated. Isn't that fair, Jim?
I'd say that's fair. I know. But where are you performing, man?
Tonight I'll be doing something at House of Comedy. Okay. I don't know.
We're still not sure if it's a prank or not.
Yeah, it may be Ricardo. It's some interview that Ricardo's doing at House of Comedy, so I'll be there. And once I'm more established at Emerald Palace, I'll be getting back in.
I'm excited for you, man. That's going to be a good gig for
you.
No doubt.
Thank you.
And then, you know, please get over to, Horizon.
Yes.
The health center, THC, Horizon THC. Go to horizonthc.com.
Peoria and I-17 is the physical location.
Man, thank you, man. Appreciate that.
It's a nice place, too. I've been
it's
there.
Beautiful. It's a very nice place. I mean, I've seen pictures. So we're going to get over there.
And East Valley peeps, too. Go see Emerald Palace out in Emerald Dispensary out in Gilbert.
I'll be awesome. There soon.
Yeah. Where's that located?
On Elliott and...
Is it Gilbert Road?
Elliott and Gilbert.
Okay.
Like that area right around
Elliott and Gilbert Road. Wow, that's downtown Gilbert.
They're so close
to
Lee.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's close, man.
It's a
nice
place.
I love what they did to downtown Gilbert, man.
Yeah.
They've really done that place up nice. Mm-hmm. So get a chance to get out there, go get yourself some weed, maybe head over to Postino's for munchies or the Liberty.
There you go.
Liberty Market, you know, which they've turned into a great restaurant,
yeah.
You know, or the farm, one of those different places. So.
Oh, yeah.
Shout out to Gilbert. And then, look, man, the struggle is real. Keep it going. Thankfully, you're no longer in that $650, you know, apartment.
Thank God.
Things have changed, I hope.
Yeah.
So you're
I got
viable.
A regular big person house now.
your bachelor pad ready?
Other adults over.
You
yeah.
have a bachelor pad? It's officially ready. Okay.
So you're a viable...
I have puppies too, man.
Man, check you got puppies.
As fuck.
That's all it took.
Dude, we're gonna get
so
man.
Dude,
you're gonna
have so many.
I do. I have weed and puppies in the backyard and chill. Watch
the stars. Come on, dude. That's Netflix and chill.
Hey,
right
ladies.
There.
Yeah. Hey, ladies. I just heard about Netflix and chill.
That's
man.
The funniest term.
I swear to God, my daughter. I was like, I asked my daughter because I had heard this on a radio station. Was it Kiss FM or somebody? And they were talking about Netflix and chill. I had no idea what it meant. And then I was like, oh, shit, that's what it means? So I check in with my daughter because she's the authority on these things. She told me about Fleek. Anyway.
I don't know what Fleek is.
My girlfriend asked me about what Netflix and chill meant, and I cracked up.
Well, so I asked her.
I don't know.
I told her it's what
chill.
We do every night. It's what we do every night.
Netflix and
chill is like, okay, for online, if you're online talking to girls, Netflix and chill is what pretty much like every guy says. Like when girls are like, well, what do you want to do? They're like, well, we can just chill at my place and watch Netflix, which means just come over to my place so I can flick your
beam. It's what it sounds like. Right, right. It's just how to watch. It's the, come on. Just, it's the one drink.
Right. It's like in the 50s when you're like, well, we can go see like a drive-in movie. They'd be like, oh, great. That's a great activity. And you know damn well what they're doing.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. It's Netflix and chill. That's cool.
So funny.
So anyway, now you have some more foo when it comes to, you know, what to say on online, I guess.
Yeah.
Well, and
you know, you don't even need to worry about it. We're taking care of it for you.
Oh, yeah, we got this.
We're on this, bro. We're on it.
This is going to, it's going to be pretty, I think we should do like 20-minute segments, man. We could,
fuck yeah.
Dude, you could probably take this clip out and put it up and.
Yeah.
And we'll do it for real, too. We're not going to hook you up with like some lunatic, like, no, we'll do it for real. We'll find you a good one.
We'll call some of my friends and you'll get a chance to see them up close and then, you know.
I've been doing so great on my own, man. So
what if we set you up on three different dates with three different girls, and we'll talk about it. We can do this.
I'm thinking GoPro. Put a GoPro in his pants.
There's really as long as it's natural and you guys aren't hooking me up like with a crazy dude in a fucking dress or something.
No, the worst you're gonna get from me is crazy strippers.
Oh,
and that's not so bad.
Yeah, they're not bad.
Yeah, there's nothing about that that I'm opposed to.
There's nothing about that I haven't already had in my life.
You need that.
Yes, I am.
Nothing to worry about there, bro.
So it is definitely recently single, and
it's on, man. It's on. We're going to do this.
Fuck, I'm stoked about it.
Well, thanks for coming out. And again, this is Mike G with the Edge Podcast. I think we had a lot of fun today. We rambled for 2 hours. It was fucking awesome. I think we need to do more of that. And we also got a lot of good content out of it. So thank you so much to Jim and Ben for being in the Edge Podcast and just sharing your lives with us. And look, man, the struggle is real. Make sure you vote. I mean, that's the last thing I want to say to you. And we're out.
Decoding visionaries and subcultures. The Edge Podcast with Mike G is brought to you by the following sponsors. Thank you for your support.
Cut my life into pieces. This is my last resort.
Cause I'm the type of nigga that's built to last. If you fuck with me, I put my foot in your ass. See, I don't give a fuck cause I keep belling, belling. Yo, what the fuck are they yelling?
Don't push me cause I'm close to the edge. I'm trying not to lose my...